Live from the Orange Bowl, USA Sports presents College Football 84. In most parts of the country, the wave is a spontaneous fan reaction. In Miami, Florida, it's the real thing. And we may see a little of each today. We're at the Orange Bowl in Miami. Hello, everyone. Eddie Doucette along with Kyle Rote Jr. And Kyle, Maryland, Miami figures to be a dandy.
I really think it will be, despite the fact that Maryland is not in early games this year to Syracuse and Vanderbilt, but have come on since then. They have a three-game win streak right now. And I think, importantly, they've been able to protect their quarterback. They have not allowed any quarterback sacks the last five games, and they're coming in here off a strong performance against North Carolina last week where they pretty much scored at will.
In the ACC, when they say Maryland, they say dominant, dominant team. They dominate in statistics, and again, for the second year in a row, they lead the pack.
Yeah, and it's a situation where this team, they do have an ACC schedule, obviously, and they're 4-0 there. But really what they're playing for today is the bowl picture, because with the three losses, they're not going to be able to have four losses, I don't think, and go into a bowl. And when you look at their schedule, they've played the last three national champions the last 3 years, and now that's a tough schedule.
They have three horses that can carry the ball in the backfield, a couple of real good quarterbacks, one in particular, who since he has taken over, has really taken over.
Yeah, Stan Gelbaugh did not start playing until about five games ago, but he has the ability to be flexible in the backfield. He is a good leader. As one of their players said before today's game, he said, you know, when he's on the field, we feel like we're really going to do something, and obviously that's true for Miami as well.
Since the second game of the year, they've had a lot of highlights, and this team is, as they say, put it all together. Offense is dynamite, over 420 yards a game, and a good defense. Let's go back and take a look at the Maryland Terrapins, 1984.
Since becoming the head man at Maryland, Coach Bobby Ross has taken a losing team to two consecutive bowl appearances. The offense is based on a running game, with rugged Rick Badonic leading the way. He scored 12 touchdowns with his bruising low-rider running style. He's 5'9", 223, a junior fullback and Maryland's favorite short yardage choice. In the last three games, Badonic has 8 touchdowns and a share of the ACC scoring lead. And he's complemented in the backfield by other talents, like the explosive Tommy Neal. He clips it at 5 yards a try. Or the versatile Alvin Blount. Here's a good one. Blount's speed has helped him average 5 yards a rush and over 15 yards per reception. He scored twice on the ground and twice via the pass. This is some trifecta. Badonic, Neal, and Blount. Since taking over at quarterback, Stan Gelbaugh has won 4 of 5 games. And his favorite target, the elusive wide receiver Greg Hill. He has 32 receptions and is number one in Maryland's receiving history. Tight end Farrell Edmonds has played his way into a starting position with determined efforts like this one. The 6'5 freshman is averaging over 13 yards a catch. And they have more. The other wideout is a sure-handed one, junior Eric Holder. When receiving the ball, the Terps are very dangerous. Keita Covington has amassed over 500 kick return yards and is averaging nearly 10 yards a try on punts. The Terps defense is led by senior linebacker Eric Wilson. Incredibly mobile, Wilson has 2 sacks, an interception, and is Maryland's all-time leader with 400 tackles. His overall play makes him a legitimate All-American candidate. And next to him is Chuck Fawcett, another Maryland linebacker standout. This man has tremendous ball reaction, and whether it's pouncing on a fumble or just knowing how to read an offense and going to the right coverage for the right kind of big play, like an interception here and there, this man is always ready for the big play in the big situations. With another ACC pennant in sight, the Terps have a chance at a record third straight bowl appearance.
A couple of years ago, they beat Miami 18-17 in Maryland. Today, they come in here against the defending national champs, a little bit of an underdog.
It is, but you know, you look at the situation, we are here at the Orange Bowl. It is against Miami, last year's national champs. Miami winning five straight games, and yet they're only an eight-point underdog, and that shows the kind of respect that people have for this Maryland ball club.
Terrapin means a North American aquatic turtle. Having had a chance to see their running backs, I really doubt it.
No, they're not slow at all, that's for sure. And they have the flexibility in that attack to be able to pass the ball. You even have gel ball rolling out on occasion. So it's not the straight drop-back passing. It's not just run 3 yards and a cloud of dust at you. They've got a lot of flexibility in the offense. They can do a lot of things.
We have another one of those situations where gel ball and Reich, the two quarterbacks, are roommates, and they've had to battle head-to-head. I think it's a friendly rivalry. Gelbaugh's got the edge right now. He's a former putter. So, in fact, what they have there is a situation that's a healthy situation, and Gelbaugh's really done an outstanding job.
Yeah, we've got really four quarterbacks in today's game, because when you add Vinny Testaverde for Miami, you've got four quarterbacks that are all over 6'3". They've got that pure pro-passing mold, and I think if either quarterback gets hurt for either team, they've got very able backups.
I think what our viewers are really going to enjoy today are the people at the skill positions. Lots of names, lots of ability, and we'll see lots of passes here today. We'll have it, and we'll take a look at Miami when we come back.
Sounds like there's a bear in the beer.
What are we going to do?
I'll be right back.
Where's he going?
He's going to get that beer from that bear.
That's not just a bear. That's a grizzly.
Yeah, but that's not just a beer. That's fire-brewed Stroh's. I thought we had three cases.
Well, had to make a deal.
Stroh's and Stroh Light fire-brewed for smoother taste.
Every once in a while, something unexpected shows up.
Hey, what's that, a Toyota?
The 1985 Toyota Corolla GTS. A Toyota, dependable. A Corolla, affordable. A different kind of Corolla. A sleeper, a car for the street, powered by a new twin cab, electronically fuel injected.
What's he got in there?
16-valve engine.
What's he got in there?
Known as the TC16.
Yeah, what's he got in there?
You know, we haven't messed up an engine all day.
It was your idea to come here.
Yeah, big parking lot, lots of cars.
Has the whole world switched to mobile super unleaded gasoline?
It's so powerful.
And it's got high octane.
Oh, what do they have against knocking and pinging?
Fellas, let's forget about mobile super unleaded.
Why?
It's beneath us.
The city of Miami and the fabulous Orange Bowl, the scene of so many great football classics, and of course the home of the University of Miami. They would have loved to have been able to spend a little bit more time here at the outset of the season. Three tough games in 12 days, and they survived it.
Yeah, they got away with that with two wins and a loss, but I think more importantly developed the kind of confidence that they could be in a position to repeat as national champions. They're coming into today's game on a 5-game win streak, but I think when we looked at their schedule at the beginning of the season, we said it was perhaps one of the toughest in the country, but the five victims of this last month or so have a combined winning percentage of only about 25%, so in reality, they haven't been playing very tough teams lately, and in particular last week did not have a very good performance against Louisville, even though they did go on to win that game 38-23.
It's hard to believe that Bernie Kosar could do better than he did last year, but I think he's duplicated and even succeeded or exceeded what he did last year. He's got tremendous numbers.
Well, as a sophomore, to set all these passing records, and in particular a guy who's able to read defenses as well as he does, he hit about 54% of his passes last year, is well above 60% this year, and you just kind of wonder, what can he do for an encore in his junior and senior years?
We talk about Brown and Smith and Shakespeare, his receivers, but you can't talk about Miami without mentioning Alonzo Highsmith. What a brilliant young runner, only a sophomore.
Yeah, another sophomore who I think in a couple of years, perhaps after Flutie wins the Heisman this year, year, he will be Kozar's biggest competition for the Heisman Trophy the next two seasons.
I like their offense. They roll up a lot of yards. Their defense isn't bad. They've got some real outstanding people. 423-plus yards total offense, and with Bernie Kozar at the throttle, you know it's going to be an exciting day.
First-year coach Jimmy Johnson has the Canes on a five-game winning streak. They're 8-2 overall. Brilliant sophomore quarterback Bernie Kozar has set 16 school passing records this year, and he's not particular either. He's thrown his TD passes to six different players. The majority have been to Speedy Eddie Brown. On this pass to Melvin Bratton, it was the rookie's determination that created Kosar's 19th touchdown pass of the year. His guys run precision pass routes, and that's the kind of running that has helped Stanley Shakespeare grab five Kosar scoring strikes. Tight end Willie Smith has really blossomed into one of the nation's finest and Kosar's favorites. He has 50 receptions so far. One of the keys to Miami's passing attack is Kosar's ability to stretch out a secondary. And long passes to speedy wideouts like Shakespeare will do just that. Or he can get it deep to his other wideout, the mercurial one, Eddie Brown. All that passing makes the defense ripe for the power running of Alonzo Highsmith. Highsmith has five 100-plus yards rushing games. And he has speed, he has power, and he even strides like a show horse when he has to. Look at here. Backfield mate Darrell Oliver possesses pure speed and a slashing style, which he's parlayed into 345 rushing yards and a couple touchdowns. Defensively for the Canes, free safety Darrell Fullington has a knack for making the big play, including five interceptions. And defensive tackle Kevin Fagan clogs up running plays with his strength. He's everywhere. Junior linebacker Bruce Fleming leads all the Canes in tackles. He's the emotional leader of this Miami defense, and he's been playing with the pain of an injured knee and hip all year. And while the Hurricane fans are seeing orange, Coach Johnson talks about his view atop an 8-2 record.
Well, you know, I'm, of course, happy with the way the team has played this year. We've had our ups and downs, but most of the time the downs came when we had some players injured. And so right now we're in a pretty good position, but we've got a big ball game with Maryland, and Maryland's at the top of their game right now. They're playing as well as anybody in the country, so it's quite a challenge for our football team.
An interesting sidelight of last week's game was the double record established on one play by Bernie Kosar and Eddie Brown. Was this a perfect plan?
It's funny because you mentioned that I broke the record and that Ed also broke his career record, but I don't really have a clue what play that was. I really don't pay much attention to the individual things. The way I feel kind of about individual awards is when the team's doing well and moving successfully like we've been lately, the individual things are going to take care of themselves.
Bernie better have a perfect plan today because he's going up what they call a wide tackle six at Maryland. At times, you'll be looking at an eight-man rush possibly, but that might be deceiving also.
Yeah, I think, Eddie, the wide tackle six has not really been used too much in the 1980s. It's a defense that was used extensively in the 50s and 60s and primarily is geared to stop the run. You put eight people on the front line to try to fill every gap along the line. And the real key to it for Maryland is to be able to have the versatility in their defensive ends where they on occasion can get some help in the defensive secondary and get five defensive backs in the game.
So it looks like we may have those ends dropping off, maybe a 4-4 look, and at times even have five, six defensive backs in there.
Yeah, I think they're going to have to do that. And Maryland has used the nickel defense on occasion, has put a lot of those backs in there, particularly because this offensive line of Miami has provided good protection for Kozar the whole season.
Well, stay tuned. This could be a very exciting one because we've got two excellent quarterbacks. They like to fill the air. They've got tremendous skill people. And both these teams have something in mind, and that is bowl, bowl, bowl. We'll have it for you shortly.
Some make greatness look simple. Like the great Gretzky and Canon's new vision of photography, the inspiring T70. With the pure agility, the complete versatility of touch-button control and three distinct program modes. Now, Canon makes it simple to handle any shot. The inspiring Canon T70.
It makes the great shot simple. Out for a day just chasing the sun, or doing the work that's got to be done, or riding a race that's got to be won. Kawasaki. Now with a choice of three-wheelers that offer low prices, high performance, and about everything in between. And for one more wheel of a time, check out the all-new Bayou four-wheeler. Get the best of both worlds at your Kawasaki dealer.
Brought to you by the Stroh Brewery Company, brewers of Strohs, Old Milwaukee, and other fine beers. Buy Toyota's exciting cars and trucks for 1984. Toyota invites you to see them at your local dealer. Buy Mobil Super Unleaded Gasoline. Mobil Super Unleaded, it's really powerful. Buy Levi's jeans, cords, and shirts for quality and style that you can count on. And buy Canon, so advanced. Canon is the world's leader in 35mm photography. The scene just outside the Orange Bowl and now in as the University of Miami Hurricanes make their entrance. And we told you about the wave. I'm sure we'll see it sometime today. We've already seen the original. There's Jimmy Johnson, who is a new coach here and enjoying a pretty good season. They're 8-2 and they've won 5 in a row. At the other end, Maryland is already on the field, and now we look as we see Alonzo Highsmith. And the reason why we're zeroing in on that man is there is a question as to whether he now will be able to perform. We have just learned that he's had some knee problems. He wanted to test it. He is talking to his coach right now, and we should find out momentarily as to whether he will be able to go or not. If he does, you're going to see an exceptional young talent. On the other side, Kyle, Bobby Ross. He's the man. He knows what he has. This is a club that has won 3 in a row. They're 4-0 in the ACC. They got off to a bumpy start, but they have come back. They had a one-point loss against Penn State, and they defeated West Virginia. So they have had some pretty rough customers on their schedule.
Yeah, and Bobby has done a superb job now in his third season with Maryland. He's taken the team to 2 bowl games the last couple of years, the Aloha Bowl and 82 last year, the Citrus Bowl. And he's got a difficult shore ahead of him right now as we're taking a look at the captains of both squads ready for the opening toss. Difficult because the last 5 games of the season for Maryland are all on the road.
All right, now let's listen to the referee who will give us the interpretation, Terry Monk.
Well, I have to read some lips. Here we go.
He's turned his mic on. Evidently, it's not working. There it is. And now Terry will indicate as to which team received. That's Dan Heffernan, offensive tackle, one of the captains for Miami. And indicated Miami. Now as we look back in the discussion, you can see Miami with several captains on the field. Hurricanes have won the toss. And they have opted to kick off. So I think part of that due to the fact that the wind is coming out of the northeast, Kyle, at about 12 miles an hour, gusting a little bit better than that. It's always windy here at the Orange Bowl. And in the series, the 12th meeting between the two clubs, Maryland leads 6-5. They won the last time 2 years ago by 1 point. I really don't think you can underestimate this Maryland football team, even though they got off to that ragged start. People who have watched them play say that they are big, they are strong, they are deep, and they are hungry, and they want to repeat as the ACC champion. And they know that there's a lot of prestige involved with trying to go up against the defending national champions, and an opportunity to defeat this Miami team would be quite a feather.
Yeah, they've got also something in their arsenal called I guess you call it the Bedonic Plague. Their fullback, who scored 4 touchdowns last week against North Carolina, 2 in just 10 seconds. That's Rick Bedonic, number 40, who we'll have a chance to see on their opening possession.
All right, the kick man now moving into the picture for the University of Miami is Mark Seelig. They have a couple of kickers here. The man that'll be kicking on the extra points and points and field goals is Greg Cox, but they use Seelig to do the kicking off. So again, they have depth even at the kicking position, which is a nice position to be in if you're Jimmy Johnson. Well, he inherited a pretty good cast from the departed Howard Schnellenberger. And now going back deep to receive, number 1 is Keita Covington.
And they're talking some pretty lofty praise for him. He's a sophomore, and he can really move it. Now we look at Selig again, and again we'll tell you the wind is clipping along pretty good here. So Miami wants to take advantage of the wind a little late.
Covington had a problem last week. It's the only time that really Maryland had problems. He fumbled the ball twice on kickoff returns. Let's see what he does today.
Remember, if it clears the end line, it goes to the 30.
That's where it's going.
And that's exactly where it's going by way of the new rules as instituted here in 1984. So we're underway. Selig will talk to his kicking coach here and tell him and remind him again about that. The marvelous view of the broken sky here at the Orange Bowl. And we're just about set to go here as offensively the Maryland Terrapins. I can't believe that that's a North American aquatic turtle. As you just saw one of the officials fall down, a little collision there. Probably not too funny to him. They break the huddle now. One of the co-captains is over the ball. It's Kevin Glover. Eric Holder is split far to the right to the near side. Their number one receiver all time, Greg Hill. Quarterback is Stan Gilball. And the running backs, Badonic and Alvin Blount. That's Alvin Blount. And a nice tackle by the Rover back, Greg Jones. James Milling was also in there trying to throw a block. And we'll take a look at the offense now, the way they set it up. Gilball is the quarterback, Tommy Neal and Rick Badonic. Greg Hill, the wide receiver, Eric Holder, the split end, and Farrell Edmonds, a freshman end, who is a sensational young prospect. The offensive line, averaging 270, Edwards, Lynch, Glover, Holinka, and Marlevelle. Marlevelle is 6'6", 301 pounds. You like those numbers? We have a second down and 9. In motion, that is Azizadin. And Badonic. This is a powerful running fullback right here. He's 5'9 and 223 pounds. And Badonic has been piling up the touchdowns. He has 12 so far in 1984. In fact, he had 4 last week against North Carolina. Defensively, Julio Cortez. They play that 5-man front with Jones, Morris, Fagan, who's all over, and Winston Moss on the outside right. On the 50 defense, they'll play a couple of linebackers right there in the middle, and there they are, Bruce Fleming and John McVay. Fleming, incidentally, their number one tackler, with Reggie Sutton, Tolbert Bain, Greg Jones, the Rover, and Daryl Fullington, their free safety, who is an outstanding freshman ball player. Now, they play what they call a quick corner and a strong corner, and you'll see the strong corner always on the side with a tight end. Azizan in the near side. Hill is on the far side. Badonic. Good pursuit. And with a ball on the 34, they may have lost a yard. It was Winston Moss, the defensive end, pursuing on the play and doing a good job. And also number 27 coming in, the Rover back, Greg Jones. So Maryland, trying to establish the ground game, will immediately have to punt. And for Maryland coming in to punt will be Darrell Wright. He's a freshman. And back and set to receive for the University of Miami is Eddie Brown. Boy, you talk about a fellow that can fly. Brown, of course, fabulous wide receiver, already over 800 yards. Low kick for Wright. Kicked it into the wind. Gets a Maryland roll. And Brown will let it go as Maryland, with those iridescent red pants, they look like sprinters, don't they? Well, down the ball, and that's where it'll be. A 49-yard kick into the wind, and a pretty good one it was. It was a good idea. It wasn't a pretty kick, but it was a good one. And we'll take a break and let you know that when we come back, Miami will have the ball, and we'll have a chance to see sensational sophomore Bernie Kosar.
The Remington Microscreen shaves as close as a blade or your money back. Here's why. The first Microscreen shaves incredibly close. The second even closer. Remington, the fastest growing shaver company in the world and the only shaver made in the USA, says thank you to people like Mildred, David, Ed, Walter, Agatha, Dave, Hampton. From all our employees to all those who are enjoying Remington Microscreen shavers, we say we are proudly made in the USA.
These tires are all the same. Goodyear. But they're all different. Different tires for different drivers. They've got them all, and they're all very good.
Instead of a tune-up, all I needed was a little fuel filter. This saved me money.
I just got white letter Eagle ratings. Hey, looking good never hurts.
You gotta be good to be Goodyear.
Goodyear tires and auto service for more Goodyears in your car.
We're Goodyear!
We're back, and we're going to see Miami for the first time. That means Bernie Kosar. Alonzo Highsmith has tested. He says it's okay. He's going to give it a try. And watch out, because this young fella is only a sophomore, and they're saying the best ever that has run here. He has had 100 or more yards per game in the last three. If he has another 100-plus yard game today, it will tie a school record. It'll be Highsmith and Oliver in the backfield out of the eye with Kosar. Now they run a slot left, and they split the receivers to both sides. Long count. As Alonzo Highsmith testing the leg and going right side, and pull down on the play is the pickup was not that much of a gain offensively with Bernie Kosar and Highsmith, Daryl Oliver, Stanley Shakespeare, Willie Smith, and Eddie Brown. And those three wideouts are terrific. Berticelli, Moore, Sinclair Ward, and Heffernan across that offensive line. It's been a good one. The center and right guard are sensational. We have a second down and six on a four-yard pickup on the last try. Kosar over the middle, overshoots the intended receiver, Willie Smith. We probably won't see too many teams go to their tight end as often as Miami does. Well, they should. Here's a fellow that has 680 yards. He had 10 catches for over 100 last week alone.
Watch the move inside. Neil Sampson, number 75, putting some pressure on. Here comes Neil, and Kosar has not seen too much of that this year. He's not going to want to take a lot of hits like that.
He has been blasted for sacks 24 times, but when you consider that he throws it about 33 times a game, that's not that many. Third down and six. Bernie Kosar. Highsmith, the lone running back. Long count. To throw again. And that is complete to the tight end. That's Willie Smith, and they're challenging the freshman safety, Al Covington. And again, Kyle, with a six or a wide tackle six, you really only have three deep men, although that's a little bit of a misnomer because they'll drop those ends off as we talked about at the beginning. Defensively, Shank Weiler, Ted Chapman, who's an excellent player, Messner, Sampson, Dunham, and Steve Kelly on the outside. You line up six across. Fawcett is in there. He had been questionable. Eric Wilson, their number one tackler. And we'll tell you about the deep secondary a minute on a first down and 10 on the 29-yard line. Kosar with that long count again. We saw that in the Pittsburgh game. That's Oliver. And he sweeps outside. Chet Chapman is one of the tacklers. Fawcett, the linebacker, also there. He's a fine player. He has a sprained ankle, but he has said that he's ready to go also. So they'll give him a couple of yards on it. Call it a second down and six. Actually give him four. There's the secondary. Keita Covington, Bob Gunderman, and Al Covington. The Covingtons are brothers, and Gunderman is the man that you may remember was lost en route to the Aloha Bowl a couple years ago. He took a trip around the world. We'll tell you more on that. Second and five on the 34-yard line. That is Daryl Oliver. He's the tailback, and Oliver cracks in Steve Kelly, the tackler, on the play.
Eddie, we've talked about how young this ball club is, with Oliver being a sophomore, Highsmith being a sophomore, Kosar being a sophomore. You've even got some of their receivers, Brian Blades and Alfredo Roberts on occasion, Willie Smith, who caught the pass for the first down. A lot of young players in the skill positions, though they do have a pretty much a senior front line with four out of the five seniors on that offensive line for Miami.
Third down and three on the 36-yard line. Deucebacks. Kosar. And it's complete. And it's Alonzo Highsmith. He can run. He's rolled up almost 1,000 yards. Kelly and Eric Wilson, the tacklers. But as a receiver, Highsmith has 233 yards. And he averages 6.9 a try.
In addition to someone who they use for ramming speed many times inside the 5-yard line, he's also a guy who's got sprinter-type speed. And as Schnellenberger said last year, when a young man is that large and can run that fast, it's in your best interest to tuck the ball under his arm and just get it to him however you can.
He ran for two and received two touchdown passes against Notre Dame. Pretty good day for the young man, four TDs. Kosar had five touchdown passes in one game himself. First and 10. And Alonzo Highsmith again. Eric Wilson
is the linebacker and a senior and the number one tackler in Maryland history with 400 coming into this game. And you can see that Highsmith is dragging a wheel a little bit. Look at those numbers, 863 yards, 6.4 yards a carry. Is that something?
Got a brace there on his left leg that you can also see.
Only one other man in the history of this school has gone over 1,000 yards in a season, and that was Otis O.J. Anderson of the St. Louis Football Cardinals. Second and three, 49-yard line. Willie Smith again. And they're just picking their way along.
We saw this happen when they played against Pittsburgh. Last time we were here at the Orange Bowl here on USA College Football 84, they didn't throw a long pass until their second possession when they sprung Stanley Shakespeare deep on a post pattern, but they scored their first touchdown not throwing one pass over 15 yards or so.
Maryland gives up about 186 yards a game passing. Highsmith has come out of the game. Melvin Bratton has come in now at a fullback for the University of Miami. First and 10 on the 40-yard line of Maryland. Bernie Kosar, he'll give it to Bratton, first try. And Melvin high steps his way along, and he tries to fatten his 3.7 yard per carry average.
There's another freshman, number five, as we take a look at Kosar and Doug Flutie and Kelly and Elway. Sophomore stats incredible for Mr. Kosar. As we told you, Doug Flutie breaking the all-time total offense record last week, and Kosar is on a pace to do better than that before he's through.
Shakespeare and Brown are out. Willie Smith is in at a double tight end set on a second down and one on the 31-yard line. They want to pick this one up. Play action fake to Oliver. Little loop lead. And incomplete and out of bounds. Keita Covington was there to defend. Keita Covington was there to defend, and the intended receiver was Charlie Henry, the tight end.
Charlie Henry, another one of those freshman receivers, 6 feet, 4 inches tall, and Kosar lost the ball so that he could use that tall frame along the sidelines. And I'm surprised that they called it out, because the impetus for knocking him out of bounds was by the defender, and the defender was in bounds on the tackle.
On a third down and one, they tried to pick that one up by Bernie Kosar. And we're going to have to unravel the group to see what happens here. Henry will come off. They had two tight ends. They also had Alfredo Robertson. Bernie, so far here in 84, how about that, huh? 60-plus percent, 19 touchdowns, and 2,832 yards. Boy, I tell you what, before it's all over, he'll break them all.
Yeah, if he stays healthy. He's got fourth and about four, and the decision, Jimmy Johnson, is we go for it.
Fourth and about 4 inches. Ball is inside the 31-yard line. Melvin Bratton. Melvin is 6'2 and 205 from Miami. And another one out of this fabulous stable full of fillies that they have down here at the university.
Challenge for Miami the next couple of years is going to be able to get recruit some great big linemen because they've got all the backs, the quarterbacks. They got lots of youth. As we said, at those skill positions, they got to get some people up front.
Shakespeare and Eddie Brown are back in at the wideouts. First and 10 on the 27 with 7:19 here in the first quarter. Long count again by Bernie Kosar. It's complete. Third by Willie Smith. But Willie Smith's high game was 11. He had that against Florida. That ties a club record. Al Covington, the safety, made the tackle. That's a big man he just pulled out. 6'2 and 215. Look at his figures as he's the number two receiver. Actually, number one in total receptions. And now, Kyle, he may be about to tie a University of Miami receiving record in 1 year. The previous mark was 54. I believe he'll break that one today.
Yep.
Second down and six on the 23. Highsmith has come back in. And it's incomplete. Trying to go over the middle, intended for that tight end again, Willie Smith. Well, they see something with Willie. Chuck Fawcett, the sophomore linebacker from New Jersey, was right there to prevent him. He wears number 11. And there's Big Willie. Can you imagine him? He only needs three receptions. That was coming in.
Might do it here in the first quarter.
Yeah.
Third down and six, ball on the 23. This is a big play right here. Highsmith and Oliver, the running backs. Ian Sinclair is the center. Interesting story, the young man from Canada. Kosar to throw. Sets the screen, Highsmith.
Very close to the first down.
Donald Brown, the right corner, came up there to try and help. Brown just back after having had thumb surgery. And it's going to be very close to the first down, and they give it to him.
When we see Highsmith come out of the backfield, as we've told you, they use him a lot. There's Kosar, the fake, to try to get reaction in the secondary the other direction. But there's a little fluorescent tape that the referees use. And that was the target for Alonzo Highsmith. The hurdles defenders to get down to the first down.
Incidentally, Brown was the starter, and he has been out several weeks. This is the 16th play of the drive with a first and 10 on the 16. Highsmith. He is from Miami. Bruce Messner playing with a bruised thigh, and Dwayne Dunham.
Take a look at the block on the outside. It's Eddie Brown, the senior receiver. He's trying to keep people sealed from being able to get on the tackle.
Bumped out there on Steve Kelly, the outside man. Brown, for a wide receiver, not a real big guy, is a good blocker, as is Shakespeare. Second and five on the 11-yard line. Highsmith, and still going. Tom Parker tackling on the play, but not before Alonzo Highsmith made it even more apparent that he's ready to go here today.
Take a look at that big crowd here at the Orange Bowl. They'd love to see a return for the Orange Bowl Classic of this hometown team, though Florida State and South Carolina are having to say an awful lot about that, too, to the other favorites to return against the Big Eight champions.
Highsmith is four carries, 24 yards, just about his average, third and three from the three. Double tight end set. Henry and Roberts are in the block. And he'll try Alonzo again. Highsmith trying to go over the 900-yard mark. They have another game after this one. Steve Kelly, the tackler. I haven't seen pants like that since Evelyn Ashford ran. Well, those are nice.
No, it looks like they're built for wind resistance, and you would never think that a turtle would be worrying about wind resistance.
Can't believe that. A terrapin is really a North American aquatic turtle. Now I know why our producer Gary Dubin is so slow sometimes. An alumnus.
There we can see the brace on Highsmith's left leg.
Roberts and Willie Smith, double tights in the block. Third or second and two on the two. Highsmith. Ever closer. Against a Maryland defense that only yields 131 yards on the rush, and they lead the ACC in that category. Keita Covington was there.
Pretty much put the whole team in front as they're pulling guards. You got Ian Sinclair going out in front. The ball is on the one. Kosar has three running touchdowns, so he's not afraid to take the ball in himself.
Kyle, they have three tight ends in there. Willie Smith, Alfredo Roberts, and Charles Henry from Miami. Did they?
Yep,
they
exactly
did.
What Kosar did.
So Bernie Kosar, who has had a minus 210 yards rushing this year, has taken it in for one here, and Bernie picks up the first touchdown for the University of Miami, as on their first possession, they came all the way and scored six.
Well, Highsmith did all the hard work, and Kosar gets all the glory. As in the stat record book, it'll show a Kosar one-yard touchdown run, his fourth of the season. But it's the safe thing to do, and particularly when you've got an offensive line that, particularly inside with Ward, Sinclair, and Moore, all seniors, the two guards and the center.
And now we have Greg Cox in to kick. He's 30 for 30 on PATs. Had one. It's perfect. And Miami is off to a good start. The defending national champions, 7. The University of Maryland, nothing. We're at the Orange Bowl in Miami. It's a sun-kissed day. And Maryland is hoping to shine a little sun on their lives when we come back.
That's a big step, Tom.
I'm still going to go to college, Dad, but after the Army.
I thought you wanted to be an electrical engineer.
I'll be learning about electronics, and I can qualify for the Army College Fund.
If you qualify, the Army College Fund will help you accumulate as much as $20,100 for tuition.
So you're going to be a soldier?
Yeah.
Be all that you can be.
And an engineer.
You can do it.
Be a good one.
In the Army.
On the next Saturday Nightmares, Dina Merrill gives new meaning to motherly love, and Fritz Weaver's fearful fate is in the hands of his dull-witted daughter. Gina Rollins is just dying for a child, and Barry Nelson can't distinguish matrimony from murder. Wake up for the best scare on the air, Saturday Nightmares, at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on USA Tonight.
We're at the Orange Bowl in Miami. Beautiful day, and for Miami, beautiful already. 7-0 over Maryland as Mark Selig will get set to kick it off. And standing back by himself for the University of Maryland, ready to receive his number one, Keita Covington. That last drive, incidentally, 83 yards, 20 plays, 9-18 time of possession, Kozar from 1 yard out. And Covington thought about it, but he did not want to test that Miami kick team. They looked like they were hungry there, and Covington is a fellow that usually runs it back at least 21 yards a try. So they'll bring it out to the 20. Maryland will take over, and they're trailing in the game 7-0.
Tom Selig, listening to his coach after that first kick that went outside the end zone, got the ball deep enough. A lot of credit, I think, and I had a lot of respect for Bobby Ross, the coach of Maryland, as we take a look at the scoring drive for Miami. Kozar, the 1 yard run. But after those two fumbles on the kickoff returns last week, Bobby Ross kept Covington in there, returning those kicks.
Blount and Badonic. Badonic gets the carry. Blount is the other running back starting here in place of Tommy Neal. So it'll be Rick Badonic. And he didn't get too much on that one, like maybe 3 yards on the carry. That front line of Tony Edwards, Lynch on the left side, Glover, Holinka, Marlowell, the right side of the line. Second down and 7 on the 23-yard line, and that's Stan Gelball. Since he's become a starter, he has not been sacked yet. 3 interceptions. Turnout. And that is complete. And that'll go to Greg Hill, who is their number one all-time receiver and his 33rd reception of the year.
You know, what I'm getting ready to say has absolutely nothing to do, or very little to do, with what's going on in the field. Last time we were here at the Orange Bowl, the Miami fans were doing the wave as we're looking at the wave when Miami had the ball. And they finally figured out that the wave can upset the opponent when they have the ball because their offensive line can't hear the signals, their receiver can't hear the signals. They finally got it together here deep in the season. I'm proud of the Miami fans.
Tolbert Bain defensively to the near side. They run it out of an eye, and in motion going back the other way is Holder. On the pitch back. And covered on the play there by Bruce Fleming as Alvin Blount got the carry. He's averaging 5 yards per. He's a real fine runner. He was a starter last spring, and now he and Tommy Neal just about rotated that running back position for Maryland. So they get the first down.
That's their first one, and good second effort by Blount.
Stan Gelball. Since he has taken over, they've done wonderful things here. Reich, who was the heir apparent after Boomer took off last year, is now on the bench. And that's Alvin Blount. And a little short screen right. Victor Morris, the nose guard, got out into the pursuit pretty well that time as they try and prevent them from going for a second first down. Morris is number 90 in the middle of the defensive line as we look back at Kevin Glover, their offensive center, leading the way back. Holder is in, Azizuddin. Abdur Rauf Azizuddin has come out.
On the replay, we'll see another just controlled pass underneath and trying to give a little bit of space for Alvin Blount. He has 2 touchdowns receiving, has a 55-yarder as well.
Second and 5, that's Hill. And wrapped up by Tolbert Bain. Little gain, if any.
Well, we've now seen Maryland, after not being able to get a first down on their first possession, they've come out. They've thrown 3 out of 4 times, have had all 3 caught, and now have their second first down.
Miami, Florida, that's where we are. Now they tell us that he just made enough to get the first down.
So a little deceiving on the yard markers here as we pick it up on the 42-yard line. Blount and Badonic, the running backs. Badonic, the fullback. Milling is split to the near side. Freshman wide receiver. That's who it's intended for. And pressure on the play by the corner man, Tolbert Bain. Bain that time playing the quick corner. There's Stan Gelball. He is from Carlisle, Pennsylvania. The ACC Player of the Week against North Carolina last week with 269 yards and a touchdown, completing 18 out of 27. Second and 10 on the incomplete pass on the 42. Hill, far right. Holder comes down to the near side. Hill on top. And whistles all over. We may have the first penalty.
Well, we had some movement along the Maryland line.
We have offensive movement against the offensive line. We have delayed contact against the defense. We offset them. We're still playing second down.
You got the call from Terry Monk, the referee. He'll go nowhere with the football, and Bobby Ross would have loved to have picked up five there. Would have given him a situation where he only had five to go. So it's still second down and 10. We're on the 42-yard line. Maryland trails 7-0. And we have 1 minute to play here in the first quarter. Kenny Calhoun has come in at a strong corner man. In motion with the play, going the other way in a misdirection is Alvin Blount. A decent call, but Miami not really going for too much of it.
That's a good gain in that situation. It's now going to put them in about a third and four situation, which is obviously a lot better than a second and 10, but it gives them the flexibility to once again throw another short pass or go for the run, and Miami defense has got to be prepared for both.
Third down and four is the call. We're at the 48-yard line. Stan Gelball brings him up. One time he was their number one punter. He doesn't do that anymore. In motion goes Azizadin. And Badonic had it and lost it. Has been a good receiver. Caught 16 for over 140 yards, averaging 8.9 per, but not that time. So it's going to bring up a fourth and four. And what might have been a first down will now become a punt situation. Eddie Brown will go back deep, and that's the punter. Darrell Wright. Now they've changed it. Melvin Bratton is who we're looking at. He's the short man. Brown is the deep man, and Brown stands back at the 16-yard line. Spiral into the wind, and a fair catch call for, and Eddie Brown and the Miami Hurricanes will take it over on a 35-yard kick, and it'll be at the 17-yard line. So Kozar, we'll see what he can do this time. We have a 7-0 ball game, Miami over Maryland. Want to let all of our local affiliates know that we're coming their way on USA, and we will return right after this.
You have to draw the line someplace. Then, cross over it. That's how new ideas start. How new worlds open up. Technology from a company called TRW helps chart new worlds. Today, we draw the line where it has never been before. Tomorrow, we'll cross over it. Tomorrow is taking shape at a company called TRW.
On the next Seeing Stars, Paul McCartney's life has been filled with firsts, and now his first screenplay comes to the big screen. Meet Paul and see how Give My Regards to Broad Street brings back memories of the Beatles. Find out why All of Me may be the funniest movie yet for Steve Martin and Lily Tomlin, and preview Joe Beth Williams' romantic adventure, American Dreamer. I'm Jim Finnerty. Join me for Seeing Stars at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific on USA Today.
Miami's ball, first down and 10 on the 18-yard line. Bernie Kosar will have his team out there. Willie Smith, Dave Heffernan, Alvin Ward, Eon Sinclair, the center, Mike Moore, and Berticelli on the left side. Sinclair
from Canada, drafted number 2 in the Canadian Football League draft last year, opted to come back and play another year here at Miami. Highsmith and Bratton are the running backs. That's Bernie Kosar. Bratton the receiver. And Melvin is all the way up to the 27-yard line. Eric Wilson, that big hitter at linebacker, was the stopper, and now Kosar is 6 of 9 and over 40 yards so far for the day. We have played one quarter here at the Orange Bowl in Miami, and so far it's the University of Miami 7 and Maryland nothing.
So hold up! Go! Lighten the load! Lighten the load! Throw down the trunk!
They're catching up!
Get rid of the Strohs!
Get rid of the Strohs!
Good thinking, Bart.
Yep.
Strohs and Stroh Light. Fire brewed for smoother taste.
What does it take to excel?
I know the deadline. You'll get it tomorrow.
It takes speed, reliability, economy. It takes express mail next day service from the post office. Our 2-pound pack is just $9.35 overnight. And we deliver over 95,000 packages on time every day.
Yes, we got them. Oh, and Jerry, thanks.
Express mail service. We deliver excellence for less.
Hello, darlings. It's me, Fernando, and I got to tell you, you look marvelous, and you look even more marvelous if you watch Cover Story on the USA Cable. I'll tell you that right now, darlings.
Meet all the people that are Billy Crystal on USA's Cover Story at 7:30 p.m. Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, today.
Night Flight brings back the classics, the work of Eurythmics, and salutes Roxy music and its influences on Night Flight at 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific on USA tonight.
Where can you get a kind word?
You're such a pretty nurse, Frida.
Some fun in the sun. A helping hand. Even a breathtaking view. The Alfred Hitchcock Hour. Sundays at 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 Pacific on USA.
It's the University of Miami 7, Maryland nothing. And we are at the Orange Bowl in beautiful sunny Miami, Florida. And the Hurricanes have possession of the ball, and they are 2 yards away from another first down. Ball is on the 25-yard line. Kosar with Bratton and Highsmith, the running backs.
Oh, yeah.
And he's got Melvin Bratton. The speed of Keita Covington would save another 6 points as Bratton made a nice catch and a lot of clear sailing.
Well, you wonder who they're going to use on the first deep pattern. Is it going to be Eddie Brown, their split end sprinter? Is it going to be Stanley Shakespeare? No, it's their tailback out of the backfield. A freshman, Melvin Bratton, number 5, a 60-yard pass play. And there's some of that size and some of that sprinter speed. Say he could be the very best in a long time. And he's along in that backfield with Alonzo Highsmith. That's pretty high praise.
They have 3 other freshmen to go along with him. A sophomore in Stanish, a sophomore in Highsmith, another sophomore in Darrell Oliver, as Keita Covington being tended to. He may have taken a heel right there in the midsection when he tried to pull the running man down. We want to again take a little break here, let our local affiliates know that we're coming their way. Miami 7, Maryland nothing.
Norelco Rotatract, the shaving machine that challenges the world. Every blade, every electric, in closeness, comfort, speed, and performance. Only Norelco holds a charge up to 3 times longer than any leading razor. Only Norelco packs 3 floating heads with a patented twin-action shaving system. Get it? And like it, or get your money back. Remember, only a Norelco performs. looks like a Norelco.
The new American Business Morning. Faster, more fleeting, with time more precious. And UPS is there, meeting the challenge every business day. It's UPS Next Day Air, and that means getting it there. Keeping pace with morning deliveries to more people and more places than ever before.
UPS Next Day Air. Morning, morning, morning.
UPS Next Day Air, getting it there. Every business morning.
Getting it there.
Miami 7, Maryland nothing. Kosar just hooked up with Melvin Bratton on a 60-yard pass. And now the ball is sitting on the 15-yard line. Maryland leading by 7. Highsmith is one of the backs. There's Willie Smith. A flag is thrown, and Willie Smith on another completion. Al Covington, Keita's brother that plays the safety, and they drag Big Willie down. So another first and 10.
What a deft touch for Kosar, as he had a lot of pressure on him after he released the pass, got put on his back. That's about the fourth time that's happened today. There's a flag down on the play against the defense.
The numbers in the first quarter, and now a replay.
Take a look at the pressure coming from the outside by number 30 for Maryland. That's Scott Schweinkeller. And he puts the ball outside. There you see the flag coming down very close to the first down. On the earlier pass, the long one to Bratton, Bernie Kosar, as a sophomore, became the all-time passing yardage leader. And let's hear about the foul.
You got pass interference against the defense. We'll play a first down on the 2-yard line.
There's the call, Kyle. And with the new rules, that means what?
Well, we've got a first down right here. It's either at the point where the foul occurred, or we've got 15 yard, which is the maximum distance that the ball can travel. If the ball is thrown over 15 yards, it comes back to a 15 yard mark from the original line of scrimmage and gets a first down. As I was saying, Kosar breaking Jim Kelly's all-time career passing yardage. And so now we've got Kosar closing in on 5,500 yards.
So again, some more confusion. Eric Wilson is number 55 and the defensive captain for Maryland, along with Bernie Kosar. And that is the lead man, Terry Monk, who is...
should be a first down from where the foul occurred. And they, I guess, done a half the distance or something, but it should go back to the original point of the foul, which is around the 6 or 7 yard line, as I recall.
Well, they may need to reinterpret these rules again. Let's see what we have here. As Terry Monk comes back out, we'll clarify for you.
We have pass interference. It was a spot foul against the defense. The ball will be on the 7-yard line instead of the 2-yard line. It was less than 15 yards.
I will. Okay, there it is. That's exactly what we talked about. So on the spot foul, you place it right there.
But it does give them that automatic first down. So even though the pass reception and the point of the foul was short of the first down marker, they'll give them an automatic first down, and we'll now have first and goal from the 7.
And now the official has gone over to Bobby Ross to tell him, as we see the defensive set. And Maryland will come in with that wide tackle 6 look. They'll have as many as 8 men up. On the quarter, Miami with 47 yards rushing, 44 yards passing, pretty balanced. Maryland balanced also, 15-17, rush and pass. And so far, Bernie Kosar is 6-for-9. First and 7 from the 7. Touchdown, Willie Smith. That big guy got behind the safety, Al Covington. And Willie Smith has just made himself his 3rd touchdown catch of the year. So Miami has gone on top 13-0, but what do we have? A penalty called against Maryland.
For roughing the passer, as we told you, Kosar has been hit so hard. We'll see Kosar get hit again on the isolation. Shakespeare was the primary receiver. Smith was the secondary receiver. And you see Shakespeare on the corner, number 6. Kosar looking to him first, coming back to the secondary receiver, Smith.
And he has now tied the Miami single season record of 54 receptions, and congratulations all around. And only a sophomore. Now Greg Cox is in. 31 for 31 PATs this season. Wants to keep it perfect. Bruce Fleming, the linebacker, is the snapper, and he's got it. And Miami now has taken a 14-0 lead. So the defending national champions are out in good form here as they lead the University of Maryland Terrapins. Miami 14, Maryland nothing.
The new, more powerful 1985 Toyota Supra and Dan Gurney take on the Big Apple. The Supra's twin-cam electronically fuel-injected six roars up Fifth Avenue. The four-wheel disc brakes set up the high-speed turn across town. The independent suspension absorbs the punishment of city streets. How does Dan feel surrounded by all this luxury?
This is fun!
With the George Washington Bridge in sight, Dan and the Supra have brought new meaning to the term rush hour.
This is the right stuff.
The Wembley Arena in London, England, home of the Benson and Hedges Championships and site of epic tennis battles between the game's top stars. This year, Jimmy Connors returns, and 84 French Open champion Yvon Lendl makes his London debut. Together, they lead a field which includes Vitas Karolaitis and Andres Gomez, all vying for another title as the Volvo Grand Prix Circuit reaches the home stretch. The finals of the Benson and Hedges Championships from London, England on USA at 11 p.m. Eastern, 8 Pacific, Monday.
The Orange Bowl in Miami, as the wave is starting to go around. You can't see it there. The real wave is not that far away. So here it is. And it's 14-0. And Selig again to kick for the third time today. And Keita Covington, who was injured, is back in there. And now they're going to take this team and overload that side of the field, Kyle. How about that?
Well, we had the roughing the passer call. Oh, there's an onside kick. It could be dangerous. One block and he's gone. But the 15-yard penalty was assessed on the kickoff when Kozar was put flat on his back after he had released the ball well in advance of the Terrapin rusher.
As it always is, you assess the penalty on the ensuing kick. And Dan Heffernan, the co-captain, one of them, or Dave Heffernan, is on the side having his shoe taped on there. I guess he's so quick he's got to tape them on so he doesn't run out of them. All right, here comes Maryland now. They're trailing at 14-0. First and 10 on the 44-yard line. Gilboa trying to get it going. Last scoring drive, 82 yards. In three plays, it took 37 seconds. Smith on the reception, 7 yards from Kosar. On the handoff. And it is Tommy Neal, the running back that time, getting the call. And Dallas Cameron, a tackler on the play. He's a backup in. There's your scoring drive right there. 37 seconds, time of possession. That's quite a departure from the first one that was over 9 minutes, back 9:18. Well, Kosar has run for one and passed for one, and Kosar is already off to a great start. Holder and Hill are stretched to the far side. Gilball over the middle. That's Hill. And at the 50 and hit right there. Joe Colbrand, a defensive end, the man that stopped him. 13-32 here in the second quarter. Miami leading at 14-0. Guy out here putting a little flex on the crowd. Holder has come out of the game. Azizadin has come in. That's quite a name. It's such a mouthful that all of his teammates call him Ziz. Hill and Azizadin on the far side. Third down and 4 on the 50. Azizadin in motion. Gilboa, good block. And an excellent reception and then drop by Greg Hill. Almost a reception. Covered by Greg Jones, the rover.
Well, we've got another situation, another punting down. They're about midfield. We take a look at Greg Hill, who has a school record for TD passes in a career with 16. Here, the ball a little bit outside his grasp, but for a record holder, that is always catchable.
So they're going to come back with a kick right now. It'll be Darryl Wright in to kick, Eddie Brown to receive. And the Miami defense, it gives up just a hair over 317 total yards a gain, is held again. High in the air. Boy, that thing looks like a dead mallard on the way down. As Brown fields the kick this time inside the 15-yard line. At about the 14, and it's a 35-yarder for Darryl Wright going off the field. So with 13-18 to play here in the first half, Miami with a lead. Miami 14, Maryland nothing from the Orange Bowl.
Crow Wing, Minnesota and Old Milwaukee both mean something great to these guys. Crow Wing means Northern Pike, big and mean. And Old Milwaukee means a great beer, cold, crisp Old Milwaukee beer and smooth, golden Old Milwaukee Light.
It's a beauty.
And Old Milwaukee.
And Old Milwaukee Light.
Taste as great as their name.
You know, it doesn't get any better than this.
Special
seeing anchor
detail.
Right, standard butter, right, standard butter,
right. Order call, Hong Kong.
Let go of the anchor.
Liberty call now.
Most jobs promise you the world. The Navy delivers. See your recruiter or call this number. Navy, it's not just a job, it's an adventure.
The Orange Bowl seats 75,000. The Hurricanes are averaging 46,495. And they've got quite a football team here, the defending champs. An unbelievable tough schedule, unbelievably tough when they start out with Auburn, beat Auburn 20-18, then come back against Florida a couple days later, it would seem, 32-30. Then they lose to Michigan 22-14, all those games in 12 days. Highsmith and Bratt will start out as the twin running backs with Bernie Kosar, the quarterback. Ball is on the 15-yard line in Miami with a 14-0 lead. Wilson, the linebacker, looking to stunt, came through, but they break Highsmith away for maybe a half yard. And a fumble. A fumble on the play. Highsmith fumbles.
We're going to get a big argument here because Highsmith and all the orange people from Miami are going to say that Highsmith was down on the ground.
Eric Wilson was the man that was there along with Keita Covington. Let's see if we can pick it up.
Initially, Bob Arnold gets in the backfield, number 99, and tries to put a lick on him. There's the ball popping out. Well, I don't know.
Hey, his knee was on the ground.
Pretty good hit right up there on the front line by John Sabrowski, a linebacker. All right, they have excellent field position. First break of the game for the University of Maryland. Ball on the 15. Hill and Holder. Holder near side, in motion back. There he goes. And on the give with a little burst of adrenaline. It looks like Badonic, the ball carrier. Badonic with about 500 yards rushing for the year, averaging about 4 yards a carry, and he has 12 touchdowns for the season. And Bruce Fleming, the linebacker, made the stop, and now Gelbaugh checking the sideline for signals. A substitution coming into the lineup, but Julio Cortez is coming in, and they'll take out one of the corner men, Reggie Sutton. So they've got extra help in there on a second down and 6. Ball at the 11-yard line. Long count. And nowhere. Miami was ready for that one. The nose guard, Victor Morris. And that's the kind of thing that'll get you going a little bit. Morris, who is 205 pounds from Deerfield Beach, Florida, was right there. And he greeted Badonic before he got back to the line of scrimmage. There he is, right in the middle. Victor Morris, they've got Willie Lee Bruton in there also. He's a backup nose guard, but they're really trying to put the pressure on right now with a 3rd down and 9. They need some big blocks by Glover, Holinka, and Lynch, the middle of that offensive line. Gelbaugh sees something he doesn't like. And he's going to have to call a timeout. Somebody lined up on the wrong side of the line, and I believe it was his tight end. And it looks like that's who it was, Earl Edwards, the freshman. So we have a timeout here. 11:45 to play in the first half. It's Miami 14, Maryland nothing. We're coming to you from the Orange Bowl. We'll have lots more.
Got me a hard-to-please woman, so I got me some 501 blues. Know what I mean? Got me a hard-to-please woman, so I got me some Levi's 501 blues. You know they're so much more than just butterfly jeans. They shrink to fit me so personally. And now my hard-to-please woman's having a hard time pleasing me. Thanks to my Levi's 501 jeans.
Another Friday night, Saved by the Bell. Tampa middleweight Robert Q places his unbeaten record on the line when he squares off against Miami knockout artist Leroy Hester. Friday night boxing on USA. It's a knockout at 9 p.m. Eastern Friday.
Watch and listen to Night Flight, Radio 1990, and Heartlight City, now in stereo. Better than ever on USA. You won't believe your ears.
Eddie Doucette and Kyle Rote Jr., and it's 14-0, Miami over Maryland in the second with 11:45 to play in the half, and we have a third down and nine. The ball on the 14, Gelbaugh, and he's got twin running backs ready to go. In motion goes Eric Holder. This is a big call. He's got a man. It was Holder, the man that was in motion going the other way. And he's pulled down by Selwyn Brown. Selwyn Brown was one of them. And in addition, Kenny Calhoun. Calhoun, who's coming back after a fractured orbital bone and has not played at all until today. And what happens now is that they come up 1 yard shy of the first down. Maryland was 1 for 4 on third down conversions. They are now 2 for 5.
Well, I got to say, it's going to Badonic. He's their short yardage specialist.
He had 4 from close range last week. 4 touchdowns. There he is.
Badonic driving.
Rick Badonic. 5'9", 223 pounds from Ohio. Badonic with 30 career touchdowns here. Bruce Fleming was the stopper.
Look at Badonic's stats this year. 8 of his 11 rushing TDs come from within 3 yards of the goal line, and so obviously he's used to short yardage situations. They have a lot of confidence in him.
They give him a first. It's first and goal at the 4-yard line, and he's running behind an offensive line that averages 270. We have seen some huge lines. Nebraska, Oklahoma, this one. Miami's pretty good size also. That's Kevin Walker in motion. And Badonic again gets inside the 2, very, very close to the 1-yard line. Bruce Fleming, their number one tackler again. He had 19 tackles against Louisville last week.
I think they're going to just give it to Badonic again. You hate to make those kind of guesses, but they've had success. He's picked up yardage each time he's carried the ball. And we'll see, though, if Bobby Ross, a very good coach, what he goes with.
Well, I think we told you that Badonic, you see, he's all pretty much short yardage stuff, averaging 1.5 today, but all of his touchdowns last week were around 2, 3, 1 yard. Second and goal, tight end in motion. Nothing. They're looking for it. They're keying on Badonic. It's obvious that they're aware of the fact that he's the man, and Bruce Fleming smacked him pretty good.
Third and goal.
Well, let's see the decision as to whether or not there's another change. We take a look. He tries to go up through the air, but you've got linebackers for Miami, in particular number 58, Bruce Fleming, who meets him at the apex of that jump. And when you're someone like Fleming, his size, got about 225, 230 pounds, not going to give up too much.
Second and one on the one. Badonic again. He's going absolutely nowhere in there.
Come up with a fourth down.
Yeah, they had the scoreboard wrong on that one, and that looks like it could be a fourth down situation coming up now. We'll check that as we look back.
One more time. What's happening here is that his line is not able to fire out enough to give him a chance to pick any kind of holes at all. And so he's being met, if not at the line of scrimmage, a little bit in the backfield. And you see the pursuit of the Hurricane Orange. And we're going to have a timeout for Maryland to talk this thing over and to see whether they're going to try to get within 7 points or stay 11.
Well, there's Gelball over there talking to Bobby Ross. And this is the decision, as they've taken two timeouts. You get three per team per half. And now Jimmy Johnson talking to his defensive captain. And that is Fleming, the linebacker, who has been just sensational. Bruce Fleming, who's a junior from Monaca, Pennsylvania. Now Jimmy Johnson is going to get out and take a good look at it. What is he going to do here? He's going to bring some of these people off the field. He's got two men coming off right now. Now he's going to bring somebody else. At four of their people are coming off.
Going to bring the whole.
Now the whole
defense,
unit's coming over. The whole defensive unit. They're wasting time, as Maryland has had the opportunity to go to the sideline and chat. Miami now wants to huddle around their people and figure out what they do in the event it's field goal cooking time. Cortez, Selwyn Brown in there, Darryl Fullington, the free safety. The entire team, and that'll give us an opportunity to tell you that next week, USA Sports will be up at Foxboro, Mass. And it'll be BC and Syracuse. Bobby Ross's record at Maryland, you know, he's only lost one game in the ACC. He's 14-1. He's done a nice job with this school. They've got some nice tradition also at Maryland. They've put some excellent talent in the National Football League. So it's a fourth down and two, Kyle, and the ball is at the two.
Yeah, his road to the bowl game, though, he's got to either beat Miami today or Clemson next week to have a chance.
In motion, Badonic blocking. And it was dropped. What an opportunity, man wide open for Maryland. Ron Fazio, replacement at tight end. And there he is coming out. A senior who has not been playing a lot behind Edmonds and Rogers, and a chance for six awry.
Well, it was good movement inside. They gave him enough protection, and he lost the ball very well. Fazio is open. That's easily a catchable ball. Came out of the line. He's known more as a blocker. He was able to somehow get into the secondary of Miami, and should have been seven, or at least six for Maryland.
So Miami's ball in the two as they take over with Bratton and Highsmith, the running backs. In motion goes Bratton. And Alonzo tries to dent the middle of that defensive line. Sampson, Messner, Chapman, they're all in there. There's Messner getting off. He's a pretty good sized kid, 6'6", 276. We got one fellow that's 6'6", 301 pounds. They're starting right tackle on the offense, John Marlevelle. They have some very big young men at Maryland. Give him 2 yards, second and eight. Maryland trailing it by 14-0 with 7:58 to play in the half. Kosar now 8 of 11, 111 yards already. He's incredible. Highsmith. Behind the lead block that time, and he's still going.
And he gets the first down as well.
Covington and Covington were there after a fashion, but there was a huge block up front that time by Alfredo Roberts, a backup tight end.
Well, despite the fact that Highsmith is going to go off the field because he re-hurt the left leg, here you see no sense of an injury as people just grabbing at him. He keeps a low center of gravity, kind of has that Pete Johnson blasting style up front, and is able to get to the outside, muscles his way to a first down for the Hurricanes.
Scott Shankwell already ran him out of bounds after the Covington boys missed on the first shot. Oliver and Bratton now, the running backs, with Highsmith out. First and 10. Deep! Eddie Brown had to come back a little bit. He was open that time. He had his man beat deeply. Joe Kraus was the defender. And Brown had to slow up for the Kosar pass into the wind. And that, I'm sure, took something off it.
Well, it's difficult to throw the ball over about 50 yards anyway, or over 40 with any kind of accuracy. But into that wind, it makes it even more difficult. But you see how the new defensive strategy of most teams, Eddie, they're teaching their defensive backs not even to watch the quarterback anymore, just watch the wide receiver. And there indeed you saw Kraus watching Eddie Brown's face to see when the ball was going to arrive.
There's Bernie's numbers so far. 111 yards. One touchdown, 7:33. Melvin Bratton. Joe Krause came up to hit him, but Bratton is a high-stepping young man, isn't he?
Melvin Bratton, who had the 60-yard pass reception, which set up the last touchdown, hurdles the secondary of Maryland and picks up another 3 yards.
First down and 10, 7:20 in the half. Miami with a 14-0 lead. Bratton has come out of the ball game. Brown is put to the near side. Alonzo Highsmith is back in. So the sophomore Highsmith in there. Kosar to throw on the blitz. Willie Smith again. Well, I am amazed at Kosar, who does a lot of checking off. We talked about that the last time we were here, Kyle. At that time, he saw the blitz. He slipped his tight end into that under coverage, and he did a great job. And now the all-time Miami single-season leader with 55 receptions. And again, only a sophomore.
Yeah, he's the calm eye kind of in this furious Hurricane offense. And you see sidearms and around the rush. And he has really provided a tremendous sense of calm and leadership. Again, as we say, we keep saying it, only as a sophomore.
Smith with 5 catches for 43 yards. First and 10 at the 42. Oliver and Highsmith the block. And that was deflected, intended for Eddie Brown. Chuck Fawcett, linebacker, got over there and deflected it. He's 6'2", 238. But Brown, the speedy receiver, was there. He has 8 touchdowns so far this year, and he has 13 career.
We'll see some of the linebackers and defensive ends getting into the pattern to be able to tip the ball. There are the linebackers. And it prevented Brown from even having a chance to catch it.
Brown, with his 882 yards, has had some career. They sent him away to junior college because of grade problems. He says, hey, I've learned. I've learned that I have to get my education, and it's helped me in my football. Second and 10, Oliver and Highsmith, the running backs. Big rush. Darrell Oliver. And a flag is thrown, but I guarantee you he was not the first option on that one.
So we got another roughing the passer, I think. Yeah, Kosar got blasted again. They only rushed three people that time and decided to put 8 people back in the defensive secondary. Kosar scrambled a little bit. After he threw the ball, he got knocked flat on his face this time as he got hit from behind.
Messner really put on a good rush. He was 83, the first man through. But they're bringing it all the way down to the 32-yard line, and here's Terry Bonk.
We have a personal foul against number against the defense. We're playing first down.
And Frankie, he almost gave the number of the man. Fawcett is out. Richie Pettibone is in.
Let's watch again at Kosar as he goes back. Only 3 people trying to get inside, all 3 being double-teamed by the front line of Miami. Still, they get a little bit of penetration. There's the throw, and there's the shot right in the back.
Dwayne Dunham, number 98, was the man who was guilty of the penalty. First and 10 at the 32. Fumble. Flag thrown on the play. Fumble inside. Darrell Oliver was the ball carrier. Eddie Brown over discussing now what happened. And a holding call against Miami.
Come on, boys, settle down out there.
There's Eric Wilson, the linebacking captain from Maryland. We mentioned that Pettibone was in there as a linebacker. He's a freshman. He's the son of Richie Pettibone, longtime NFL player, and also now on the staff of the Washington Redskins. So Maryland's going to take this penalty against Miami. Mr. Monk?
We have holding against the offense. Still playing first down. Still playing first down.
First down is the call. It's against the offense, and Kosar will bring him out. Ball is on the 42-yard line. First down and 20 is what they're showing. Round to the bottom of the screen. Little slip screen that time, and it's Darrell Oliver. And Wilson again, along with Terry Burke. Burke, number 59, the sophomore from Silver Springs, Maryland. Darrell Oliver, he's had a nice year. He's got 350-plus yards now, averaging 4.3 yards a carry, and he's got two touchdowns rushing. But they use their people very interchangeably.
So that shows the complexity of the offense, which, again, is a compliment to how Kozar, his intelligence, the ability to come in very quickly last year and run it.
Number 37. Second and 15. Right in the seam of the coverage, and Willie couldn't hang on. Joe Krause was there. But Big Willie Smith, going for his sixth reception of the day, could not hang on to that one. Boy, for a big man, he's got nice hands, though, doesn't he?
They respect so much speed. Eddie Brown, the wide out, number 40. He's going to take him deep. You'll see Smith come underneath for the catch. There's Brown, number 40, trying to make the deep people respect that, and Kozar is just using their backpedaling as a place to put his tight end.
So we have a first and 10. That pass was complete. Highsmith and Oliver now, the running backs. Ball is on the 19-yard line. Round to the near side. Shakespeare to the far side. That's Oliver. Got three cracks and about the 11-yard line is where he is. Wilson, Krause, they were both there. And Darrell Oliver. So Willie Smith now with six receptions already with 4:21 to play here in the half. Miami 14, Maryland nothing.
Talk about Kozar's height, yes. We can talk about his arm, yes. His leadership, yes. But he also has a tremendous self-discipline, Eddie. Rather than try to force the ball into the end zone, he hit the open man, picked up a little bit of yardage, but it was a safe pass.
He's made so many records already. By the time he's through, they'll have to write a new book. Willie Smith! And again, the big tight end.
Willie Smith ought to shake hands with Stanley Shakespeare because Shakespeare brings the secondary inside so Smith can go outside into the flat and has an unobstructed run to the flag for his second touchdown.
He has seven catches and 72 yards. He has been brilliant, and Shakespeare is the man that has been kind of lost, but he's doing his job. And now it's Brett Cox that adds another. And with 3:53 to play in the half, Miami's big offense being greeted by Bernie Kosar, and they have a comfortable 21-0 lead. But don't forget about Maryland, they can explode.
McElroy, McElroy, McElroy.
You don't have to be a wizard to know that the Toyota Tercel is one of the surest ways to get from one place to another with more room inside than any other subcompact.
I'm not afraid.
The 1985 front-wheel drive Tercel, Toyota's lowest-priced car. It's got what it takes to get you where you want to go, even if it's just somewhere.
Over the rainbow.
Oh, 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 what a feeling. Toyota.
Do you know me? It's frightening how many novels of suspense I've written. But still, when I'm not recognized, it just kills me. So instead of saying I wrote Carrie, I carry the American Express card. Without it,
isn't life a little scary?
To apply for the card, look for an application and take one.
The American Express card.
Don't leave home without it.
Bernie Kosar's run for one, pass for two. His team leads 21-0. And at halftime today, we have a nice feature on offensive strategy, our Wall Street Weekend Memo, and we'll have stats and highlights for you. And we're only about 4 minutes away from that. 3:53 to play here in the first half. Selig to kick, Covington to receive.
Go, go, go!
He's at the 12. 25, and the slippery key to Covington. A 5'9", 186-pounder from Virginia. Gets outside, and Maryland will have the ball, but they're trailing by 21 points. Boy, that Miami team is something else. They can really roll up the numbers, can't they?
They've never had really good field position. First touchdown started on their own 17. Second one started on their own 18. This last time, a 98-yard drive started on their own 2.
Holder near side, Hill far side. Gelball, and he underthrows his man, Eric Holder, the intended receiver. Now, Gelball has really done an outstanding job, but this might be the toughest test he's had so far. He came on in the Wake Forest game. He started since then, and they've won 4 of 5 since he's been there. That last scoring drive, 11 plays, 98 yards, 436. And Smith, 11 yards from Kosar. He has 2, both of the touchdown passes, and Bernie's run for 1. Abdur Rauf Zizadin to the near side and Hill to the far side for Maryland. That's Ziz for short. And you can see they got Abdur Rauf on the back of his shirt. Second down and 5 on the pass. Give you a little fisheye view coming out of the man's tuba. It's pretty nice, isn't it? A little creative work right there by our director today. .308 to play in the first half. 21-0. So far, 1 of 6, and back down on the play. Big defense right there, and that was by Jerome Brown. He's coming off the field right here. Good defensive rush.
What a nice combination when you can have an offense that is unstoppable. You have a defense that has every kind of difficulty for an offensive unit to look at. This is why, again, they were national champions last year.
Tolbert Bain was on the sideline. They'll have a kick coming up to Eddie Brown.
Oh, what a kick.
Oh, that's a beauty. With the wind behind, and Brown is going to let it go down right into the end zone. 66 yards on it. But a lot of that for naught, because they'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. Darrell Wright with a pretty good boot. 66 yards with the aid of a trailing wind. And so now it'll be Bernie Kosar's turn to take over again. All he has done is lead his team. And yeah, that's what they're saying. We do want Nebraska again. You remember last year, the Orange Bowl, what a thrill that was. Next week, we'll see another bowl-bound team, BC, Boston College. And they'll be going against Syracuse. And the last time we had the Orange men, they defeated Nebraska and the major upset of the year. 21-0, 2:50. And Bernie Kosar, who's 14-19 so far. And almost caught that time by Warren Williams, a freshman running back. Joe Krause, the defender, was there. And already we're starting to see some of the troops off the bench with Williams, Bratton, a couple of freshmen in there right now. They have Steve Staffier, also a freshman. He's standing in the wings. They just bring them all. They just keep them coming. Alvin Ward is the defensive or the offensive guard that you just looked over the shoulder of. 6'1", 260, playing in his 43rd consecutive game. Second and 10 on the 20. From the eye with Shakespeare and Eddie Brown, the wideouts. That's Bratton. And Bratton manages to break loose for almost 7 yards. And interestingly enough, we talk about the wide receivers. Neither Brown nor Shakespeare have caught a pass yet.
And just looking at that backfield, I wonder if anybody shaves in the Hurricane backfield, because I don't think we're going to see Highsmith again today. He's got that tender knee. There's no need to even risk it. You've got Warren Williams in there, number 24, a freshman. You've got Melvin Bratton, number 5, a freshman. You've got Kosar, of course, a sophomore. And but talking about those wide receivers, Eddie, they have shown so much unselfishness. They continue to run their patterns very hard. Eddie Brown, number 40, and number 6, Stanley Shakespeare. That they're forcing the secondary of Maryland to react to them, and that's allowing people like Willie Smith to get underneath and the backs out of the backfield.
That man there, an All-American candidate, Eric Wilson, senior linebacker. He's an ex-basketball player. As a matter of fact, they have the tight end on that Maryland line who has been invited out by Lefty Grizzell. Pretty good one himself, Farrell Edmonds. On third down conversions now, Miami will have possession of the ball. And this is an impressive statistic because Miami so far today on third down conversions are 4 for 4. You don't get any better than that. For the year, they're 45%, which is pretty good by itself. Miami has been impressive again. 21-0 second quarter. 2:31 to play in the half. Third down and 3. Short drop, Melvin Bratt. Boy, I like that Eric Wilson, the linebacker. He can't, unfortunately for Maryland, he can't handle Miami all by himself, but he's sure giving it a good try.
No, and there are a lot of people in the NFL already talking to him. Dallas, Denver, San Diego, some quality organizations that see this record-setting tackler from Maryland as a key to perhaps their future, even in the pros.
First and 10, ball on the 36. There's Willie Smith again. Past the midfield marker and down into Maryland land. Joe Kraus, right corner. We'll tell you again that Maryland is really apple soup or apple pie. We'll get it straightened out. Apple pie for the for a Bernie Kosar type fellow because they run with three safeties, although that's a little misleading. They're going to drop people back to give them help. First and 10 on the 47-yard line. Apple soup. I'll have to try that sometime. Stanley Shakespeare near side, Brown to the 5. Boy, is Willie Smith having a day. Fawcett, the linebacker on the near side, was the stopper.
Those wide receivers have got to be in tremendous shape because they can never go a down without running a full pass route. A pass route looking at trying to make that defense react. They've got to have tremendous fitness.
Second and 2 on the 37. All right, Carol, come on. Willie trying to go for his 10th catch of the day. Willie's going to make a new record for himself here, I think. You know that 11 is the club record, 11 receptions. And Kosar's got Willie Smith in mind. As Bernie looks over and he got, how's that for a sophomore? You see that little blink and a confident little click of the teeth there as he looked to the sideline. Now this guy plays like he's been in the NFL for 10 years. Smith so far 9 for 102. Thanks to the arm of Willie Kosar and the good patterns that Miami structured for this tight end. Third and 2 in the 39. Four-man rush. Melvin Bratton.
Get out of bounds.
With 1:24 to play in the half, Chuck Fawcett. Playing with a sprained ankle, but moving pretty well. As Melvin Bratton. We've seen a lot of him today, the freshman, 6'2 and 205.
Pick up another first down.
When are they going to turn Stanley Shakespeare loose, huh?
They're just saving. They're waiting until they try to stop the run.
Kosar with 218 yards. He's 17 for 23. How about those numbers? Wow.
Shakespeare's also being double covered just about every time, too.
Double pump. Warren Williams. Man's got extremely quick feet, they tell us, and a track performer in high school, one of the best. He's from Fort Myers, Florida. There's Bernie again, picking it up. Now, he'll pick up all the plays from the side, but he has the option to check off when he gets to the line of scrimmage. We haven't even completed a half, and look at what we had. 218 yards and 2 touchdowns. He ran for the other. In case you just joined us, 21-0, Miami over Maryland, the number 6 team in the nation. And Kosar's arm was hit that time with a good rush by Bruce Messner. That was a good, clean rush on the 6'5 quarterback.
Always fearful of rib injuries in that type of situation. He was going against Alvin Ward, who last week, number 72, we'll see him as the right guard for Miami. Ward got, he punched a Louisville player because of late hits on the quarterback. We've already seen several that have been penalized. Perhaps last week the referees were not throwing the flag, and Alvin decided to take justice into his own hand.
Well, you got to protect that golden arm. Not that you you advocate that kind of action, but, you know, frustrations. Third and 10. Williams. And the ball was thrown behind him. He was in between the defenders that time. But look at the drop coverage that Maryland is using now on Miami. Well, they've got 5-6 backs out there now trying to cover the zones and trying to cover the people that Kozar is used to throwing. We have a fourth down and 10. Referee forgot to turn his mic off down there for a moment. Or was that the field mic? Fourth and 10 on the 31. And we're going to see a field goal. It'll be from Greg Cox, who's 11 for 14. The ball will be kicked from the 38-yard line. This is going to be a long one. 48-yarder. Into the wind. Hey, he's got it. A 48-yard boomer. And things are going well for Miami. They lead it 24 to nothing. We have 1:03 to play in the half.
Pretty accurate as a point after kicker, and not bad with the wind at his back. Or into the wind, I should say. And there you see the V for victory with the arms upraised.
Careful who you high or low five like that. You don't want to break somebody's wrist. Danny Swingle has now come in the ball game. Keita Covington is back. Swingle is on the far side short. Some other scores for you. That's a big game right there. Florida and Georgia. And Miami keeping a close eye on that one. Houston over Texas. Uh-huh. Second quarter action. We're at 24-0 here in West Virginia and Rutgers. That's a sleeper, that Rutgers team. We saw them against BC a few weeks back and liked what they're doing up there. Boston College and Army. 28-7, we'll see BC and Syracuse next week on USA Sports. Cox is going to kick now. Selig had been kicking, and he keeps this baby on the ground. Short. Oh, it looks like Tommy Neal, the running back. Tommy Neal, the running back, who was up short on it. Might have been Pat Dietry. We didn't get a good look at the number. It was either 46 or 48. And there's Cox coming over after having kicked that 48-yard field goal. He's having a nice year. All right. We've got Hill and Abdur Rauf. We're going to call him Ziz for a while. How's that? Gelball. Short on the screen. Wow. Julio Cortez coming up and blasting Tommy Neal, the intended receiver. We're under a minute, 52 seconds.
Well, this screen, everyone could see it coming all the way, as you can see some of the Miami linemen and the linebackers knowing what's going to happen as well. The quarterback has really got to set up about 6 yards and stop and hope that the defensive lineman will start chasing and then back up. He can't just have a continual drop and keep backpedaling, because it's obviously what's going to happen. They're going to throw the screen.
Rejected Bobby Ross of Maryland. Eric Holder is far. Hill is on the near side. Gelball on the drop. Intercepted there. That's Reggie Sutton. And out of bounds at the 30-yard line with 43 seconds to go in the half, and Miami looking to add more. And a man down here from Maryland on the field, one of the linemen, looks like it might be a tackle that's gone down on the play, Tony Edwards.
Gelball throwing the ball a little bit too high. He sets up pretty well that time. The ball flies. And with the interception, here's the decision by Reggie Sutton. Hey, I just want to give Bernie a little bit of time. Don't want to take it in all by myself. Don't want to embarrass the man. He's only got 30 yards to go, and he's got plenty of time. He's got more seconds than he does yards. 43 seconds left here in the first half.
Here's Tony Edwards being aided off the field. Sutton is another one of those youthful corners that they have. He's only a sophomore. As Tony Edwards being assisted by Kevin Glover, the senior center and co-captain. Gelbaugh now is 6 of 14, only 35 yards, and he's been intercepted once. That's 6 times for the year.
And that's only the first time. He hadn't thrown an interception in 39 passes coming into today's game, so first interception in about 45 passes, which is an acceptable ratio.
I said 5. That's the 4th interception for the season. He's been pretty accurate. He's not been sacked since he's been a starter, so he's had nice protection. All right, Miami now with possession of the ball. Sitting just between the 30 and 29. Highsmith and Oliver, the running backs. Brown to the near side. Stanley Shakespeare to the far side. Four-man secondary. Bratton again. Oh, my. He is splitting the seams in the coverage now. Keita Covington. And Miami is flawless as Kosar just looped it over the undercover that time and got it inside the deep people. And the rest is all down in the books.
We talked about the difficulty to wide tackle six. You've got to have very versatile defensive ends who can go with the backs, and obviously they don't. They're doubling on the wide receivers, on Shakespeare and on Brown. They're leaving the center of the field open for these runners out of the backfield.
And as we get back to the live action, Kosar trying to get his team across for another score, and it's just short. And Bernie's going to take a timeout.
Timeout, Miami.
So Miami's going to take one of their timeouts as Alonzo Highsmith tried to crack through there. Miami with a 24-0 lead, and we have 20 seconds remaining here in the first half. And again, it gives us an opportunity to remind you that at halftime we have a very interesting feature. We have our Wall Street Weekend Journal for you, and we'll have stats and highlights. All of that from the Orange Bowl in Miami. I hope that you're enjoying the number six team in the nation going against a Maryland team that has had a lot of success in recent weeks. They've won three in a row. They're 4-0 in the ACC, and they're a team that can score a lot of points. They've not shown that here today. Miami has dominated. They've kept the Maryland defense on the field for a long while, and we've not had a chance to see that Maryland offense that has put on an average of 28 points a game.
No, I think the Miami defense was really insulted last week in giving up 23 points to Louisville. And they got a pretty good verbal lashing by all those Miami coaches that we're looking at on the sidelines, and they have come out as if today was a bowl game.
Second and one from the one. Kosar. Bernie Kosar trying to get his second TD. And I don't think he got it. We're going to have a timeout by Miami again.
It's their last one, so they're going to have to, this will be the decision right here.
And they're looking to try and score, add to the 24-0 lead.
They got third down, and you know they could potentially try just a rollout.
Next Thursday night, November 15th, USA's NHL will be at the Nassau Coliseum in Uniondale, New York, when the Minnesota North Stars take on the New York Islanders. Steve Payne, Mike Bossy, Pat LaFontaine, some of the top names in hockey today. NHL, next Thursday, 8 o'clock Eastern, the North Stars and Islanders on USA.
And that's exclusive coverage of the NHL for many years now. Hope you all will take that in.
So Miami will come out with 15 seconds to play in the first half and see if they can knock another one in. And they're going to bring in a three tight end set. Willie Smith, Alfredo Roberts, and Charles Henry. Got two freshmen and a sophomore tight ends.
Don't be surprised to see a play action rollout here. He's got third down. He can still throw the ball away. But, you know, with three tight ends, you'd think they would run.
On the one, third down. Bratton in motion. Just like that. Charles Henry, the freshman tight end. They are amazing. Maryland's looking run. All Bernie does was drop back and pop it over the top. And he's got his third touchdown pass, and Miami is sailing right now.
Everybody up on that line, three tight ends in, but they still had 15 seconds to go, still had a fourth down to kick the field goal if they wanted to or try the run. And they're with Kosar, the cool Kosar at the back. You know that he's not going to get sacked. He'll throw it away if he can't complete it. This time he completes it.
Cox is in. He's going to have to put that leg on ice at halftime. He's really wearing it out. And he adds another. Miami is moving it along, and they're leading it 31-0 at halftime, scoring with 12 seconds remaining in the first half. So the Hurricanes, they want to climb that ladder. They like it at six, but they'd like to move closer to the top and get another shot at the Orange Bowl. And boy, I'm telling you, that Boston College-Miami game on November 23rd is going to be something.
Well, also, they've got this situation where with two losses, they've got to impress some people. You got South Carolina, who a lot of people think is a favorite for coming into the Orange Bowl. And with the eight bowl reps here in attendance, obviously, victories are going to allow Miami to pick and choose a lot more than carrying another loss into the bowl season.
Miami is a team that averages about 28. Maryland likewise. Keita Covington, the man you're looking at. Doug Burmeister is also in. Covington, Swingle, and Burmeister. Burmeister and Swingle are the short men. Scoring drive of a little over 29 yards. Took them four plays. 46 seconds, and Henry on the one-yard catch. Sean Scott, defensive lineman. And he was tackled by, take your pick, any one of a number of Miami Hurricanes. So Maryland now with a lot to think about at halftime. How do they reconstruct what has been a very fine team here these last 5-6 weeks? They've run into something pretty good. They've run right into the eye of the Hurricane today. Miami will take a very healthy lead to halftime. Now, who's at fault? Miami says that they were drawn off. Maryland said Miami jumped off. Terry Monk will tell us. It's against the University of Maryland. That's an illegal procedure call against Maryland.
Timely.
We have dead ball, illegal procedure against the offense. First down.
Could have been the tackle on the left side that made the move. Now coming near side, they've got Farrell Edmonds at tight end. They've got Trips on the left side. Three receivers left. Gelball is going deep, deep. And Edmonds is there, but he cannot hang on. So the basketball playing tight end, Farrell Edmonds, is going off in a smiling Bernie Kosar. The last time we were here, he limped away against Pittsburgh in a win. Today, he's running and smiling and leading. At halftime, it's Miami 31, Maryland nothing. Don't forget our feature, our Wall Street Weekend Journal, and our stats and highlights when we come back.
Some make greatness look simple, like the great Gretzky and Canon's new vision of photography, the inspiring T70. With the pure agility, the complete versatility of touch button control and three distinct program modes. Now, Canon makes it simple to handle any shot. The inspiring Canon T70.
It makes the great shot simple.
A few months ago, something new burst on the American scene, the Toyota Camry. Experts were impressed.
Peppy performance with fuel economy. U.S. News and World Report.
And it's got room.
Technical tidbits and thoughtful touches. Car and driver.
And it's got room.
A landmark vehicle. The Christian Science Monitor.
The 1985 Family Camry from Toyota. Boy, has it got room.
Oh, what a feeling. Toyota.
If you're looking for a really good job, I have a word of advice for you. Look in here, in the National Business Employment Weekly. Every week, hundreds of job opportunities from every regional edition of the Wall Street Journal. And you know what that means. Top jobs in top companies. At salaries from $25,000 a year up to $250,000. Top jobs. And every week, expert articles on how to write better resumes, come across better in interviews, what the going salaries are, when to change jobs, when not to. Important articles, useful articles. The National Business Employment Weekly. If you want a really good job, this can help. Believe me, it's my business to know.
Ask for the National Business Employment Weekly at your newsstand. Or if you prefer, you can have the next date issue sent by first class mail for $32. Just call toll free, 800-255-5000. That's 8 weekly issues, $32. Call 800-255-5000 now.
At halftime, Miami 31, Maryland nothing. Three touchdown passes by Bernie Kosar. He snuck one across himself and a field goal, and Miami's offense just dominating this game so far.
Yeah, Eddie, it is a surprise to me, and as I guess to everyone else, because particularly the way Maryland's been playing the last few weeks with the knowledge that this really is their only opportunity, I think, to impress a lot of bowl people, you would have expected them to do much better.
Okay, Kyle. Well, we've had an opportunity in recent weeks to see the Kosars and the Fluties of the world, and it's a pleasure for us to do that. It brings to mind college football offense is wide open, and they found out that this is a quick way to open the game. Today's halftime feature, Kyle looks at the offensive strategy.
Offensive strategy in college football today has reached a level of sophistication unheard of 20 years ago. Computers assist in game plan preparation, more time is devoted to film analysis, and players are becoming increasingly involved in decision-making on the field. Deciding how to attack your opponent's defense is a complex problem that involves many variables.
What we're looking for a lot of times is, first of all, where they line up. You know, what plays do we have from the positioning that they line up in? Then the next thing you want to see is what they do from there, where they slant to, if they change defense right before the ball snap, things like that. And then lastly, more the coaches look for, I think, than we do, and the linemen also look for this, is what kind of guy is it playing against them.
Maximizing your offense means taking full advantage of the opposition's weaknesses. The coaching staff constructs a game plan accordingly, and because of its complexity, the assistant coaches have taken the responsibility of calling the plays.
Myself and the offensive coaches, we study it. They have suggestions. We analyze every suggestion. We put it down on paper, a game plan. As a matter of fact, this is the type of plan we're going with. Those are all plays in certain areas of the field of what they like to do. And during the course of a game, each coach has a responsibility to watch what the defense is doing, and we may have to adjust, and they come up with suggestions and based on what they're doing, and then it's my decision to pick the play and call it.
The selection of a play by the coaching staff does not necessarily end the decision-making process. Today, many teams give their quarterback the latitude to make further adjustments at the line of scrimmage.
We run some two-play huddles, what we call two-play huddles, where we'll have an either-or chance where we can go to the weak or strong side of the defense depending on what they give us. So this helps our offensive line in that they don't have to block particular fronts that really are a disadvantage to us.
The biggest change in offensive strategy over the past 5 years has been the tendency to open up the attack, become more inventive, and throw the ball more. The trend had its roots on the West Coast and gained exposure with the emergence of teams like Boston College and Miami. Today, offenses all over the country are more wide open.
I think the rules have helped college football to a certain extent, in fact, that the pass protection rules now have enhanced the chance to throw the ball a little more because you can a little more liberal on that. But I think that's basically the difference, is the pass protection rules. As an offensive coach, I'd like to see the hash marks moved in like the pros, because most college teams defend the field, and, you know, it's not very far from the hash mark to the sideline.
Even without the rule changes, Boston College's Heisman Trophy candidate quarterback Doug Flutie would have succeeded in opening up the offense. Now the NCAA's all-time career total offense leader, Flutie is the master of making adjustments. His grasp of the game and offensive strategy enables him to function almost like a coach on the field. And if he were a coach, there's no doubt he'd employ a passing offense.
Now, when you're a passing football team, you take a lot of the brute strength and physicalness out of the ball game. You add in, now you're taking advantage of finesse and maybe outsmarting a team. And that's where even a 1AA school can compete with a Division I school if they have an outstanding passing game. You're not just butting heads against each other and going at it. You can now out-finesse a team. And I think that's the way we got started a couple years ago. We weren't as strong as some of the big powers in the country, yet we could compete with them because we could move the ball through the air.
Offensive strategy is constantly evolving, sometimes emphasizing the run. But whatever the current trend, the offensive minds will never rest in their quest to always remain one step ahead of the defense.
And a very interesting halftime feature. 31-0 Miami over Maryland. Been an interesting first half for them. Miami with 335 total yards, Maryland only 56.
Norelco Rotatract, the
shaving machine that challenges the world. Every blade, every electric, in closeness, comfort, speed, and performance. Only Norelco holds a charge up to 3 times longer than any leading razor. Only Norelco packs 3 floating heads with a patented twin-action shaving system. Get it? And like it, or get your money back. Remember, only a Norelco performs like a Norelco.
Seguin, Texas, and Milwaukee both mean something great to these guys. Seguin means barbecue at its biggest and best. And Milwaukee means beer. Cold, crisp, old Milwaukee beer. And smooth, golden old Milwaukee light.
And old Milwaukee.
And old Milwaukee light.
Tastes as great as their name.
You know, it doesn't get any better than this.
It's the University of Miami's Hurricanes 31, the Maryland Terrapins nothing here at halftime. While we have a few moments here, we're going to take an opportunity to send you back to New York for a look at the business world and Bill Bruce with our Wall Street Journal weekend memo.
Cooking the books next.
The Wall Street Journal weekend memo with William Bruce, brought to you by Lowenbrow.
I think I found some candles.
I got the matches.
What's that?
Here's to good friends.
Power company.
How about a little blackout party?
You're crazy.
Not entirely.
The beer we'll pour must say something more.
Oh.
We need to finish the Lowenbrow. That's better.
Let it be Lowenbrow.
In reporting to shareholders, companies can sometimes be tempted to use creative bookkeeping to gloss over their problems, to turn red ink black or black ink blacker. Take McCormick & Company. The SEC recently charged the giant spice maker with reporting sales of goods that were in fact not sold. Groceries allegedly shipped to warehouses for future sale in a scheme involving phony invoices and 2 sets of books. It's called cooking the books, and it's now a top priority of SEC investigators.
When 3 or 4 different executive vice presidents are running for the brass ring to become president or chairman of the board, one of their sales might begin to fall off. And in order to remain in the race for the brass ring, they will cook the books in their division in order to give the appearance of profitability, hoping to make it up later.
Greed usually has to do with a bonus. He gets a greater bonus for more profits. He gets more salary. He may get more stock options.
The SEC list of companies charged with cooking the books has stunned the investment community. While most big companies do play by the rules, every investor, large or small, is a potential victim when a firm cooks the books. I'm William Bruce. This has been the Weekend Memo.
You know, we haven't messed up an engine all day.
It was your idea to come here.
Yeah, big parking lot, lots of cars.
Has the whole world switched to mobile super unleaded gasoline?
It's so powerful.
And it's got high octane.
Oh, what do they have against knocking and pinging?
Fellas, let's forget about mobile super unleaded.
Why?
It's beneath us.
Miami's Dow Jones is up. They're leading at 31-0 at halftime. We'll have stats and highlights and more when we return to the Orange Bowl in Miami.
Flight operations, Hawaiian Islands.
155 is the go bird.
And the green stripe runner.
Bring up 155 on number 2 elevator.
Cloud top to 28,000 feet.
Alpha Hotel, your wind is down the deck at 28,000.
Most jobs promise you the world. The Navy delivers. See your recruiter or call this number. Navy, it's not just a job, it's an adventure.
It was moving day. Things were going great. Till the moving truck died at the toll booth gate. The troopers were glaring. Tempers were flaring.
Do I hear swearing?
What's more, it started to pour. The The tow truck came and we gave a cheer. Then the couch slid out the rear. Now I know Ryder trucks are newer. They're tougher, they're strong. And driving a bargain sure didn't pay. So next time I'll think this way. It's Ryder or it's wrong.
Miami 31. Miami 31. Maryland nothing. And there were some doubts at the start of the game about whether Alonzo Highsmith was going to be available, but I don't think he ever had a doubt. He came out there roaring, and you have to start the highlights with Highsmith.
And Eddie, this Miami muscle man has was really questionable for the game. He's got a bad left knee. He's only a sophomore. He's feared more for his battering ram style of running. Shows he's very adept on the receiving end as well. As on the screen pass from Kozar, it's Highsmith nearing his way for a first down. He hurdles the Maryland defense to get there. And that put Miami in position to give the ball to Highsmith again. This time, straight drop, straight up the line. And it's Kozar over the goal line for Miami, taking a quick 7-0 lead. Howling Hurricane mascot and fans watched as Kozar this time, with his double wideouts, double covered, finds Melvin Bratton wide open for a 60-yard gain that puts the ball well again into Terrapin territory. Kozar overlooking the defense. And the Hurricane hurler hooks up with a 7-yard touchdown pass to sophomore tight end Willie Smith, and Miami is up 14-0. For Bobby Ross and the Terp coaching staff, it's catch-up time as the game plan has to be modified. About the only thing that stopped Miami has been Miami. And this time, Alonzo Highsmith fumbling the ball as he's tackled. Maryland picking up the ball, unable to go in. On the ground, they try it through the air, and Ron Fazio, unfortunately, drops a catchable pass. With Shakespeare running interference and clearing out the flat, once again, it's Smith for the touchdown. And now Miami takes a convincing 3-touchdown lead. Gelbaugh trying to get something going, throws the ball a little bit high. It's Reggie Sutton bringing the ball back. Goes out of bounds. A field goal had already been kicked, so it was 24-0 as Kozar looking deep again for Melvin Bratton, with wide receivers still being covered doubly. Kozar inside, third down, 15 seconds on the clock. Able to hit inside as Mr. Henry is able to put the Hurricanes up 31-0. Again, Maryland only an 8-point underdog. They've got a long way to go, Eddie.
Kyle, next week, College Football 84 will be in Foxborough, Massachusetts, when the Orange Men of Syracuse take on the Eagles of Boston College and their Heisman Trophy candidate, Doug Flutie. So join us next Saturday at 12 noon Eastern. We'll be live when Syracuse goes against Boston College. That'll be a very interesting ball game. At halftime here, it's the University of Miami 31, Maryland nothing. Maryland's in there trying to do something about it. We'll be back to the Orange Bowl in just a moment.
Out for a day just chasing the sun, or doing the work that's got to be done, or riding a race that's got to be won. Kawasaki. Now with a choice of three-wheelers that offer low prices, high performance, and about everything in between. And for one more wheel of a time, check out the all-new Bayou four-wheeler. Get the best of both worlds at your Kawasaki dealer.
The new American Business Morning. Faster, more fleeting, with time more precious. And UPS is there, meeting the challenge every business day. It's UPS Next Day Air, and that means getting it there. Keeping pace with morning deliveries to more people and more places than ever before.
UPS Next Day Air. Morning, morning, morning.
UPS Next Day Air, getting it there, every business morning.
Getting it there.
If you're an investor, here's an important telephone number from Charles Schwab and an important message.
I worked hard for my money, and I want my money's worth when I buy or sell stocks. That's why I use Charles Schwab, the number one discount broker. I make my own investment decisions, so I like Schwab's policy of no sales pressure, no advice, and no passing judgment on my buy or sell decisions. I like saving up to 76% on commissions compared to what full commission brokers charge. And I like getting services you wouldn't expect from a discount broker. Fast, accurate transactions, clear monthly statements. I'd say I get more than my money's worth with Charles Schwab.
I'm Charles Schwab. You'll like our low commissions, our convenience, and our quality service. That's a promise.
For a free booklet telling what Schwab Discount Brokerage can do for you, call 800-458-6400 toll-free. That's 800-458-6400. Charles Schwab, a Bank America company. Member SIPC.
College Football 84 is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? We're at the Orange Bowl in Miami, and hello again, everyone. Eddie Doucette and Kyle Rowe Jr. And Kyle, I had a feeling that Miami would be ready, but not quite this ready. Maryland has not even been present here today the way it's been going, and Bernie Kosar has been sensational again.
No, I'm sure we were not getting false clues from the Miami coaching staff here sitting next to us, because before the game, they were very, very nervous. Again, that poor performance against Louisville last week, they were not sure what they could do. Despite their nervousness, they're able to walk into this halftime pretty confident, because even if they're able to score, begin scoring lots of points in Miami, at this point, the only thing that has stopped that Miami offense has been themselves, and Maryland's got to have a great defensive effort to have any kind of chance at all.
Bernie Kosar has had as many as 373 yards in a game. Today, he has 240 already at halftime. Are we going for a 400-yard day?
Well, if the running backs have anything to do with it, and the tailbacks, yes, because they're the ones picking up most of the yardage, and you're going to see perhaps the people coming out of the backfield getting much, much more yardage on pass receiving than they are running, because again, they continue to double the wide receivers from Miami, and of course that does allow those seams to be open for the running backs coming out.
Willie Smith has already established a new record for receptions. We haven't seen Stanley Shakespeare or Eddie Brown. Maybe he'll turn them loose in the second half.
Well, we haven't seen them catch the pass. We've seen them run all over the field and have two Maryland defenders chase them wherever they do go, and again, that has cleared out lots of space for these other receivers from Miami to get into.
On the other side, Badonic, Neal, and Blount have really been shut down. Their running game has not been there. Their passing game has been non-existent. It's been a tough first half. 56 yards so far for Maryland.
Yeah, I've been a little bit surprised, because as I watched the North Carolina game the other day, it appeared like Maryland was able to score almost at will. They really had no problem. The only time they did have problems is when they turned the ball over, Covington fumbling the ball twice on kickoff returns. So it is a little bit surprising. I'm sure they went into the halftime locker room a little bit shell-shocked because of the confidence that they came into this game with. There was no fear at all in the Maryland Terrapin locker room before this game.
Are you expecting possibly that we may see Mr. Reich here in the second half, the one-time starting quarterback?
Well, as we've seen many times in the past, a lot of our USA coverage, we've seen some great quarterbacks, Marlon Adler and Warren Seitz, and at times when a coach does have two good quarterbacks, he's got that advantage to be able to try someone new. Not that your starter is a bad player, but sometimes you just need a new look. So it would not surprise me to see that at all.
All right, we're just about ready to go. Miami will be back to receive to start the second half. Jess Atkinson will get his first opportunity to go to work. He's the all-time leading scorer at the University of Maryland, and currently number two all-time in the ACC. Darrell Oliver will be one of the deep men getting set to receive from Miami. And I believe it'll be J.C. Penny on the far side.
What this tells us now, though, Eddie, is that Miami, when they won the toss, elected to receive at the second half because had Miami just elected to kick off, and obviously Maryland would have received the ball this half.
It's a short onsider. And Maryland trying to come out of the blocks here and get something going right away, I think may have been unsuccessful in their attempt to get it back on the short onside kick.
Recovers the kickoff for the Hurricanes.
You know, it's really not a bad play because Miami has not been able to be stopped at all. They started inside their 23 times, started inside, actually four times, started on their two-yard line once. As we take a look, oh my goodness.
Houston over Texas at halftime. Boy, that's a big one.
Well, this is just what Miami was looking for. They needed an explosive victory today. Two top-ranked teams.
That's a big one there also. Florida and Georgia. Miami's keeping an eye on that one. Highsmith and Oliver are the running backs. Bratton, incidentally, recovered that last kick. Bernie Kosar is the quarterback. 31-0. We start the third. And that is Alonzo Highsmith. Number 84 there, incidentally, is Willie Smith, the tight end, trying to do some blocking. I wonder what else he does. Boston College at halftime over a tough Army team, one of the better Army teams in a long while, 28-14. And again, we'll tell you, we'll be there next week. Syracuse and BC, and looking forward to that because Boston College is always entertaining. Rutgers 20, West Virginia 10. My, my, what a surprise that is. West Virginia with a fine club and Rutgers with a building team. Second and eight. Underneath, and he tried to thread the needle that time. That was intended for Daryl Oliver and wrapped up by Eric Wilson and Chuck Fawcett, the linebackers.
Mentioned the score of the Boston College Army game, Eddie. Is
those are the statistics from the first half. They tell it all, don't they?
Look at that passing yardage. Mentioned Boston College, and Flutie today only has to go 231 yards. We see 240 for Miami. He only has to go 231 to become the all-time career passing yardage in NCAA history.
Third down and eight. We're at the 43 in the third quarter. Kosar under a pretty good rush, and he got it away. And Highsmith went down. Did that knee cave in on him? I think it did.
Yeah.
I think it did. He went down before he was even hit.
I'm really surprised they decided to play him for that reason.
Wow.
Take a look. This is an absolutely perfect time blitz by Maryland. It's Eric Wilson, number 55. Kosar has no chance to think at all. And actually, it was Highsmith really on his cut with his left knee. He did not get injured while he was being hit. He did it himself.
And he is in a little bit of pain down there, being tended to. What a perfect call, though, by Bernie Kosar. He checked off, he saw the blitz coming, and he hit his man quickly. My goodness. Highsmith, 11 carries, 43 yards, a couple of catches for 23. He's hurt. Miami leads 31-0.
We're a team that's going places, hitting the road for the open spaces, working or playing, we're easy and free. My boy Chuck and me, my boy Chuck and me.
When you're serious about your work and serious about your play, too, you'll go for the one that's built for Tough.
A Tough Boy Truck and me.
Soldier, we know you. Courageous and brave. The country you honor. The flag that you wave. Soldier, thank you. On Veterans Day, you're the pride of America.
From the people at Coors to America's veterans.
You're the pride of today.
Back at the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida, Eddie Doucette and Kyle Rote Jr. on USA. Miami 31, Maryland nothing. 14 minutes to play here in the third period. Ian Sinclair with Bernie Kosar, the quarterback. Brown to the bottom of your screen. Oliver and Bratton, the running backs. That's intercepted. Intended for Eddie Brown. And Scott Shankweiler, a defensive end who drops back into that short coverage, has got a big turnover. Well, they had one earlier they couldn't take advantage of. And that was intercepted, intended for Eddie Brown. Interception number 13 so far for Bernie Kosar.
I think Kosar, frustrated, as perhaps a lot of our viewers are, with not seeing the Eddie Brown or Shakespeare get too much attention on the receiving end. And I think Kosar trying to pull a miracle out to get the ball into double coverage. And it is Frank Reich in at quarterback for Maryland.
Farrell Edwin's coming from the near to the far, or the far to the near side. There's Reich. On the pitch back, that's Alvin Blount. So Alvin Blount has a 6-foot, 201-pounder from Maryland. Crowd pretty happy about what's going on here today. I'm just happy to be here myself, to be honest with you. Here's Reich now. He's a senior, 6'4 and 210 as we look in. And he was the heir apparent. He got hurt in the Wake Forest game. And the numbers for him, and you can see that he has also been fairly impressive. He is 64%. He's actually considered to be a better passer than Galbois because he has a stronger arm. And he was a guy that just kind of labored in anonymity when Boomer Esiason was here and waited for his chance this year. And then when he got his chance, he was injured.
Yeah, he's got a mild separation of that right shoulder, and unfortunately, know, someone who is going to pass the balls, obviously. He's in his fifth year. As we take a look at Highsmith, who's having that left knee looked at and attended to, and they manipulating a brace that is on his left knee. You see the trainer on the left with a pair of pliers trying to get that thing straightened out. I really am surprised, Eddie, that the Miami coaching staff put Highsmith back in, particularly because of the way the game was going and with their big game against Boston College coming up.
43 yards for Alonzo. Second and one at the 42. Close to and getting a first down, the running back on that play. Winston Moss was the tackler. Blount was the man that carried the ball. Alvin Blount, B-L-O-U-N-T, averaging 5 yards a carry, 6 feet, 201 pounds. Also a pretty good pass receiver. Blount, incidentally, had 109 yards rushing against West Virginia. That's a pretty good feat when you consider that big line he was running against. So it's a first down and 10. But Donick and Blount, I believe, are the running backs. That's it. Play action fake. And Reich with a neat pass that time to Hill. To the 10. He's going to go. Touchdown. Crossover, Reich to Greg Hill. And the third touchdown cast for Hill this year. He's averaging over 15 yards a catch. And he is the all-time leading pass receiver in Maryland history.
So nice to see a player like Hill who has no fear of running over the middle. He took one of the hardest hits I think I've ever seen against North Carolina last week. Here he's going across the middle. He knows that he's ripe to get hit. He reaches up for the ball, leaves that midsection open, but uses some sprinter speed to get outside. With that catch, has broken a school record for total yardage in a career. Already has the school record for TD passes in a career. And that's his 17th.
And Atkinson adds the extra point. And suddenly Merrill is on the board. For Atkinson, he had been 22 of 23 in PATs, but they've got a long way to go. We have a lot of time. It's Miami 31, Maryland 7 on USA Sports.
What does it take to excel? It takes speed, reliability, economy. It takes express mail next day service from the post office. We'll deliver your urgent packages overnight. And our 2-pound pack is just $9.35, about half what most others charge. So next time, use the service that delivers over 95,000 packages on time every day. Express Mail Service. We deliver excellence for less.
Do you know which of these oils gives you the best engine protection under the toughest driving conditions? Sub-zero cold or blazing heat? This one, Mobil 1. Now, Mobil 1 and our other fine motor oils come in this easy pour, resealable plastic container. Mobil Motor Oil. Now it's easier to use than ever.
What would the caption read? Down but not out? I think that's fair. Frank Reich, he gets them a scoring strike, a 39-yard pass. And it goes to Hill, their fabulous receiver, and it's 31-7. And now Jess Atkinson will kick off as we go back to that last play.
Take a look one more time, and Reich drops back. He's looking at Hill all the way as there was a crossing pattern on the outside. Hill tried to get just behind the linebackers, just in front of the secondary. Did that, caught the ball, and used speed to go to the flag. Well, we used to call it a flag. It's not that anymore. Runs to the foam, I guess, is what you say.
Pylon. They call them pylons now. Kind of like a tackle pylon. That's Atkinson coming up to kick. He was cut from the soccer team. Can you believe it? Look at this ball. And the ball is received by J.C. Penny. And caught from behind at the 13-yard line. Pretty good popping down there. Louis Askew, who is one of the hitters, as he comes away and going back to that Maryland drive. Three plays, 52 yards, and a minute and four, 39 yards. Hill from Reich with Love. A 13-yard return by J.C. Penny. Nothing like a few free promos here, a few free plugs. Yeah, to give that kid some stock. 12-28 in the third period, third quarter. First down and 10. Ball is on the 13-yard line. Oliver and Bratton are the running backs. Highsmith is hurt. They come from the eye. And that is Darrell Oliver. Oliver only had 7 yards in the first half. Bruce Messner, defensive tackle, 6'6 and 276, was one of the initial hitters. Come back, you see Willie Smith, the tight end. He's had a day so far. 96 yards in the first half alone with 9 catches. That's 2 away from tying the school record for the most catches in a single game. He holds it. Bernie Kosar checking off now, 2nd and 8. And that's Big Willie again. He's at 10. That ties what he did last week when he had 10 for 124 yards. Keita Covington.
Very close to the first down.
Got those little people matching up on him.
The danger for Miami right now is emotionally to try to stay inspired and be aggressive. Sure, they're 24 points ahead of Maryland, and it would take almost a miracle for Maryland to come back, but you don't want to ever let seep into your team that attitude that you don't ever want them to quit producing. And it'd be very easy just to kind of go in, get 4 downs, maybe pick up a first down or two, and not get a first down, go for a touchdown, and just punt the ball. But right now, Miami has got to just keep moving the ball, keep developing their confidence, know that even when it's easy, they've got to keep producing and not to let any kind of momentum shift at all. They come up to a game next week or 2 weeks from now against Boston College or in the bowls where they don't have a 24-point buffer.
3rd down and 1. Ball on the 22. Kosar stumbles. Bratton. He does not get a gain. And we always watch Kosar when he goes down because of that sore ankle. They are now 8 of 9 on 3rd down conversions, and that's going to bring up a 4th and 1.
Well, this will be the first time that Miami, I believe, Eddie's had to punt today. They've had touchdowns, field goals, 4 touchdowns, a field goal. Gave up the ball on an interception, gave it up on a fumble, and this time we just see the penetration really by number 55, Eric Wilson. And Rick Tootin coming in to punt for Miami.
And Keita Covington is back to receive. Nice kick into that wind. Covington at the 34. And good kick coverage right there. And that is Mr. Fleming again. Bruce Fleming, the linebacker. He is a tough hombre, isn't he? We have 10-15 in the third quarter. University of Miami 31, Maryland nothing.
Soldier, we know you, courageous and brave. The country you've honored, the flag that you wave. Soldier, thank you. On Veterans Day, you're the pride of America.
From the people at Coors to America's veterans.
You're the pride of today.
Stop!
Hey, who are you?
Excuse me, I'd just like to check out your small size Ford Ranger. That's an advanced engine.
New electronic four-cylinder fuel injection, but...
I see Ranger's roomy.
Widest cab of any small truck. But who are you?
Big payload, too.
Wow, 1,765 pounds. But who are you? What do they call you?
Melvin Fenstermacher, Cedar Rapids, Iowa.
America's truck, built for tough.
University of Miami, and that number 45 down there has a familiar name. Myra, son of George Myra, the passing quarterback. Outstanding performer who Bernie Kosar passed earlier on that all-time QB list here at the university. He is now number 3 all-time passing behind Kelly. Kosar is Miss Demira. And the wave sweeping the Orange Bowl. We'll have a 1st down and 10 with the ball on the 40 in the third quarter. 10-15 to play in it. Miami with a big lead, 31-0. 31-7. Maryland having just scored. Reich is the quarterback. But Donick and Blount are the running backs. And that is complete again to Hill. Well, this combination seems to work pretty well. It's the second in a row they've hooked up for, and that's a pretty sizable gain.
Maryland using a little rollout there. It gives him the option to run. He did have a good opportunity to run. Let's take a watch. The isolation is Greg Hill, number 44. The wideout for Maryland drives back, cuts it off short, comes back inside against Tolbert Bain. And underneath.
High formation. First and 10 of the 45. That's Blount. Inside the 40 to the 38, 37-yard line. There's that big tackle we talked about. Marleveld, 6'6", 301 pounds. Glover, the center, co-captain. Polinka, Lynch, some of the people up front. There's Marleveld. You got to look at the back of him. Sorna, another one of the offensive linemen. He's a freshman, 6'5", and 280. Hill now has caught five passes for the day, 71 yards. He has 37 for the season. Second and two. That's Holder in motion. Defended by Tolbert Bain. It was intended for Eric Holder. And number 18, Bain, who is a redshirt freshman, only a 5'11", 185 pounder. But he stayed right with it.
It's really one when you want to throw the ball a little bit earlier and loft the ball. The ball is thrown on a line. Not a very good fake to the outside. As here comes the deep pass. It's Greg Hill trying to go deep. But he did have a little bit of room behind Bain had the ball been lofted earlier. But you got to make a good fake. Try to get some kind of movement from that secondary man before you take it deep.
Reich with two completions, 54 yards. He'll have Abdur Rauf and James Milling stretched to the right side. That's Blount. And down inside the 35-yard line. Bruce Fleming is there again. Fleming has been a big, big man today. Cameron also in there, Dallas Cameron. And a first down for the University of Maryland. 31-7, they trail.
Well, they've done something that they had to do, and that was break the momentum. Show that they could put some points on the board, too.
First and 10. Reverse. Hill. And the defense was right there. Kevin Fagan lost his helmet, still managed to pull the man down. 260 pounds, 6'3". And he's from Lake Worth, Florida. He's everywhere, isn't he, fella?
They've been running away from him all season long. And a lot of times when they're grading films, he gets graded on so few plays because they're never really running at him. He anticipated the block that he was going to have from number 70 there from Maryland. That's Kevin Glover, the center. And played off the block, made the tackle.
Second and 12 on the 35-yard line. Reich. And overthrown or underthrown, depending upon which receiver he was going to. Milling was the short man. And the deep man on the other side was Rauf. Well, this man seems to have a little bit more of a grasp of what he wants to do with the ball when he throws it. Gelbaugh just couldn't move the club. Now going back to Fagan for a moment, wouldn't you run away from a fellow that could bench press 525 pounds? That guy could lift up my car. They are 2 of 8 in third down conversions. Maryland, 3rd and 12 on the 35. Holder and Hill. That's Hill. And he drags his man to the 1-yard line. Now he had Tolbert Bain one-on-one, and that's what they've been looking for all day, to get that isolation. And again, we'll tell you that Maryland can score points. They average 28 a game, and they're starting to find the route.
Here you've got a senior against a freshman. And Greg Hill, number four, the ball is lofted this time. You see the trajectory. It allows someone like Hill to change his receiving style, his running style, and he gets behind Bain. He had single coverage out there.
Bain is taken out. They bring the rover back in, Greg Jones. First and one. They're on the one-yard line. And they're trying to get it in. It was Bladonic, the running back, short yardage man. Zifazio, the tight end, that dropped that one in the end zone. Dallas Cameron, the tackler.
He's got to be on 8-inch line.
No gain on the play, second and goal.
They're saying no gain, but I believe you. I think they're probably about 6 to 8 inches away. Third quarter, 7:06 and ticking down. Reich is the quarterback. That is Kevin Walker in motion.
And
I think he broke the plane. Yes, he did. So Maryland now starting to put some points on the board. And they're going to bring their kicker, Jess Atkinson, in here.
We're going to bring in a boxing umpire, too, as we're getting some fisticuffs on the field. Here you see the double back take, back and forth, trying to confuse the defense. That's Kevin Walker, the running back for Maryland. And really what they're just trying to do is to get the timing of the linebackers off who are, here's the call. Personal foul against Miami.
And the discussion going on with the quarterback, Frank Reich.
We have a dead ball, personal foul against the defense. After the touchdown, it'll be assessed on the kickoff. We have a touchdown.
And that tells the whole story. So they'll march it off before the kickoff. And Atkinson will be the man. All-time leading scorer at the University of Maryland, second in the ACC. And it's 31-14. So Maryland is starting to put some numbers up there.
So watch again, there's the timing of the linebacker trying to meet him at the apex of the jump, expecting the ball going to one of the running backs, and that's the advantage for Frank Reich, the quarterback, is that by the time those linebackers get to the line of scrimmage, he has already cleared the goal line.
Kyle, I think we've got a pretty nice ball game coming up next week. How about you?
Oh, my goodness. You've got, again, the guy that I think today is going to break the all-time passing yardage record, the guy who's the total offense leader career in the NCAA.
We have a 31-14 ball game here, and we'll be right back at the Orange Bowl.
Soldier, we know you, courageous and brave, the country you honored, the flag that you wave. Soldier, thank you. On Veterans Day, you're the pride of America.
From the people at Coors to America's veterans,
you're the pride of today.
What would you call a video recorder that has everything?
I'm calling smart.
It's a Zenith VHS with extraordinary VHS hi-fi stereo.
Smart.
Plus a remote that can control both the deck and the TV.
Controls both? That's smart.
And clear special effects.
Smart.
One of the new smart decks, Zenith VHS video recorders. When you want everything.
Very smart.
We're at the Orange Bowl in Miami. And the University of 31, Maryland 14. We have 6:53 to play here in the third period. Bobby Ross is on the side. I think he senses he's found a combination, and it might be Reich and Hill. Reich so far, 3 of 5 for 88 yards. He's done a nice job. J.C. Penny and Darrell Oliver will be back, and Atkinson will get set to kick. Believe it or not, we talked about Reich and Gelbaugh rooming together. Atkinson also rooms with those two. He might have to put the, he might have to referee a fight or two himself after this one.
Imagine so. He sleeps between them, as you can imagine.
They're trying to come up short, and that's Brian Blades. He lost the football, and Maryland may have it back. We'll have to wait and see with flags down. A freshman wide receiver named Brian Blades was the man that was going for the kick. He got a little hasty with it. Let's see what happened. 31-14.
Well, here's Atkinson just trying to loft the ball up in the air, get lots of height, not much distance. A fair catch is called for, which is allowed. And I'm not sure why the flags were thrown unless they didn't give him enough room to properly catch the ball. I'm going to guess that's what it is.
Well, of course, with the penalty having been assessed on the kickoff, as we had heard from the official, now we'll get the call on this one.
Yeah, fair catch interference against the kicking team on the kickoff. 15-yard penalty. We'll play it first down from here.
You're right, Kyle. That's what it was. And the Maryland bench not happy with that call at all. 31-14. Miami with the lead and the ball. Bernie Kosar, the quarterback. Oliver and Bratton are the running backs. Big rush. Screen. Bratton. And an excellent effort by Melvin Bratton before Keita Covington banged him out of bounds. How's that for a broken play?
We talked about the right way to run a screen, and watch what Kosar does. He's looking to his left. He's looking back. He's trying to show a little bit of panic here. He stops momentarily, then gets the ball out to Bratton. Bratton takes a shot, then spins away, Tony Dorsett-like, and picks up some blockers. It now looks like a punt return wall, as only Keita Covington keeps him from the end zone, and Covington throws the shoulder into that young runner.
53 yards on it, Kyle, so they take advantage of the penalty and the big return. And now they'll try and crack in over that side as Darrell Oliver handle a football. And again, we see Eric Wilson, Tom Parker, the nose guard. Boy, that Eric Wilson has had a busy, busy afternoon.
If you look at Bratton now with two receptions over 50 yards, over 100 yards receiving, obviously.
Downtown Miami, they have to be very proud of this football team. Great representative, as are the Dolphins. 5:59 in the third. Melvin Bratton. Well, it could have turned things around completely had that kick been ruled a little differently. But now Miami taking advantage of the field position. And the big screen pass to this man, Melvin Bratton, right down there on the two-yard line. Third down coming up on the two, and the clock ticking away, under 5.5 to play in the third. Kosar with Oliver and Bratton, the running backs. And he lobs it short.
He's trying to get it to Melvin Bratton, who is knocked down at the line of scrimmage. And Shakespeare was deep in the end zone.
Well, after Bratton got knocked down, Shakespeare coming from the far side was there, but there was no call, and so it'll be a fourth down situation.
Got 11.
And so they'll bring in Greg Cox again, who already has a 48-yard field goal. 5:11 in the third, and the scoreboard showing let's do it again. Has been an impressive kicker, hasn't he? Oh boy, he's got it, and it is 34-14 Miami. A 21-yard field goal.
And that means that
Maryland's got a 19, Kyle.
Yep, they have to come back with three touchdowns to to be back in the ball game by just three scores and three touchdowns. I'm sure that Hurricanes are disappointed, but the second half has been all Maryland. Is Maryland two possessions, two touchdowns for Miami. The interception by Kozar, his first of the game, stopped one drive. They had to punt for the very first time, and pretty much to this point, the whole second half has been the Terrapins.
So now with a 34-14 ball game and 5:08 to play in the third quarter, C-League will be in to kick it. It'll be Swingle, Covington, and Doug Burmeister. That's the man in the middle, Covington. And we've really not had a chance to see him break one loose yet. Mark C-League, who is usually their kickoff man, except we did see Cox the last time. And the reason being, of course, was that they had the penalty, a shorter kick. But Selig is usually the real deep man. He'll also kick field goals over 50 yards. Covington with a good running start at the 15. And hit by one of the Blades brothers, Benny Blades, at the 20-yard line.
Guess what year he is, Eddie?
Yeah, another freshman. They're going to have to unlock these two. Look at this. Looks like a wrestling hole, doesn't it?
We've got not only the NHL on you here for USA, we've also got some outstanding wrestling. And if you're into that, please check your local cable system guide and be with us for all of our wrestling coverage.
You're into hats. How about that one? What are those little people on top there, huh?
Call them Harry Canes.
Harry Kane.
Harry Kane.
Oh, I
yes.
Like that. That's good. Frank Reich, the quarterback. Hill and Holder, the wideouts. Twins to the right side. No question about that one. That was Jerome Brown.
Well, it's the offensive line's fault. At that point, the right side has got to fire out and leave a passing lane for the quarterback.
McVay and Fleming, incidentally, are the linebackers. We're down to 4:37 to play in the third now. Win is 34-14, Miami with the ball. Maryland trailing, Abdul Raouf and Greg Hill. Twin receivers, right side. Tommy Neal. We've not seen a lot of Badonic here in the second half either. Jerome Brown again. A little fun in the sun. I guess that's the best way to describe what's going on here. We have 4:00 to play in the third. Houston hanging on. What a big one that one would be for them. That's in the third. Florida leading large over Georgia in the fourth. Right here, Maryland trailing 34-14. Eric Holder. And Holder over the 30-yard line.
What a key play that was. Third and long, third and 10. Holder gets the first down.
Joe Colbrand and Greg Jones were there to tackle.
Showed that Florida score, and you mentioned the Miami Dolphins and their tremendous record. Miami is certainly very proud, but the state of Florida has had a lot of success as Doug Flutie, a touchdown ahead of the Army.
West Virginia and Rutgers. Rutgers still hanging on there. That would be a big upset. First and 10, ball on the 33-yard line. Now, there was nowhere to go that time for Tommy Neal, so he decided to take on the linebacker, Bruce Fleming. That's a pretty good hit, and I believe that is Alonzo Highsmith. Yeah, that's really a shame. That kid there is a sensational talent. Holder comes out. Highsmith, who is going for a 1,000-yard season. And with his yards today, he's over 900. He's only got one game left to do it in, so hopefully he'll be better in time. Holder in motion. Neal. Anyway, excellent second effort there.
Now, this is what Maryland was doing against North Carolina and what they were unable to do the whole first half. Auburn 21 over Cincinnati.
Harbin, one of the teams that played Miami at the very outset of the season. Maryland, incidentally, with the three former national champs in their schedule. Only team in the country to do that. The last three national champs, they have them all. That's Frank Reich. And that is complete. I believe that that is Abdur Rauf. That's who it is. Azizuddin Abdur Rauf, who used to be a quarterback in high school and was all everything from the Baltimore area.
Reich drops back, hits the strike to Abdur Rauf. Inside, a little curl pattern, deep curl pattern. And another first down, and Reich is driving it, mixing up the pass and run.
Under two to play in the third. Greg Hill comes to the near side. Out of the eye. It's Hill. And he is out of bounds at the 28 and a half yard line. Boy, he's a dandy receiver, that fella.
Well, Greg Hill is really picking on Tolbert Bain. It's right after this catch, he does go out of bounds very close to the first down. And as you saw moments ago, he was pointing his finger back at Bain as, "I'm going to keep getting you day, time after time, pass after pass."
James Milling now has come in for Hill. So they have Abdur Rauf and Milling, the wideouts. Reich is 6 of 8, 126 yards. And a touchdown. He's done a nice job since coming on here in the second half. Sadonik. And he took on the tackler, but he may have stepped out of bounds before that. Darrell Fullington. And they're saying, no, it's going down close to the 5-yard line. Boy, that little guy's like a bowling ball. Remember Charlie Toler that used to play for the old Houston Oilers?
Yeah. Receives the ball pretty well. He finds himself against Darrell Fullington deep in the secondary as he breaks the first tackle. And you notice that Fullington does not get Badonic on the ground.
First and six. On the 6-yard line, a chance for Maryland to score another. Well, we told you they were explosive. With the tight end into block, Badonic down to the one.
Badonic, the ball carrier.
Rick Badonic with a minute and 20.
Tackled by George Myron.
Badonic with a very, very low center of gravity. Surprisingly, despite the average there that you see, he's been much more devastating than that, and got about 4.7 speed in the 40, which is very fast for a fullback.
He had 23 yards in that last run, so he's net 21 for the day. He had lost yards before. There he is again.
If the stats are correct, I'm not sure that they are, but...
Are you questioning?
I'm questioning, yes.
Badonic carried.
We're down to the final 35 seconds here in the third quarter. And Maryland trying to knock it in for another one. This is the Orange Bowl.
Third and goal at the 1-yard line.
And a third and goal on the one. And Miami with one game left, and that's on the 23rd against BC. Maryland in the second half, 195 yards, 149 passing and 46 rushing. So they have improved considerably. And that is good to Blount. Well, they are really starting to find some holes here, Kyle.
Well, taking a page out of the Bernie Kosar Miami Hurricane book from the 1-yard line when everyone is expecting Badonic, who's done it so many times. Little fake inside. It's number 33 there at the right halfback who has to avoid one of the Miami defenders to kind of juke himself into the end zone for Reich to be able to drop the ball in. So three possessions in the second half, three touchdown passes.
And this very explosive team from the ACC could make it 34-21. Jess Atkinson is in the kick. The holder is Frank Reich. He's got it. With 5 seconds remaining here in the third quarter, Maryland is starting to make some noise. 34-21 at the Orange Bowl on USA Sports.
Very long drive for Maryland that time, something that, again, they did not do at all in the first half. Mixed up the passing and getting much better control out of the passing game with Frank Reich at the helm. And it's obvious that his right shoulder separation, if it was bothering him, probably he's thinking nothing of it at this point.
Bobby Ross is thinking about what they can do in the fourth. If the defense can hold and they can be as productive, could see quite a surprise. They went 11 plays, 80 yards, time of possession, 5:08. And now it is 34-21.
Reich had the stats coming in. Jimmy Johnson is no doubt not only concerned, but trying to make some kind of judgment. The joyful Jimmy Johnson we saw in the first half is no more.
Jess Atkinson getting set to kick away to an 8-2 Miami team from the 40. Oliver and J.C. Penney. And they'll bring it out to the 20, and that'll give them one opportunity to get something going here in the third quarter. Jess is saying, hey, what's going on?
Well, there was nobody back there to receive his kick, as all of the Miami players were up expecting another onside type kick, short kick.
Atkinson kind of looking over toward the Miami bench as if to say, whoa, what are you doing? Here's your last scoring drive, 11 plays, 80 yards, 5:08, and Blount from Reich. And Reich has been the answer here in the second half for Maryland. Final play here of the third quarter. Darrell Oliver.
Darrell Oliver on the carry.
And when we resume here in the fourth quarter, it'll be a second down and six. Maryland so far here has put together an impressive third quarter. And for the quarter, 196 yards, whereas for the first half, only 56. It's 34-21, Miami over Maryland. We'll have more. Eddie Doucette along with Kyle Rowe Jr. And Kyle, the numbers are getting a little bit more realistic as far as Maryland is concerned.
Particularly in the area of total offense, is now Maryland's come up with a little over 250 yards of total offense. And of course, so much of the Miami yardage was in the first half, 410 total yardage to this point.
All right, here we go. Bernie Kosar, second and six on the 24-yard line. Melvin Bratton and Darrell Oliver are the running backs. That's Oliver. Oh, what a hit. What a hit that time. And that was Steve Kelly, the defensive end. Kelly, part of that wide tackle six line, and he can drop back and cover as a linebacker or even as a defensive back at times.
Yeah, Darrell Oliver is now going back to the huddle, and he's saying, Bernie, next time you see them read the screen like that, throw it out of bounds.
Actually, with the fellow like Kelly in there, they'll normally take him out, bring another defensive back in when they want to go to their dime coverage that they call. Rather than a nickel, they'll bring in a couple of extra backs, take out the drop men on the ends, and give you a five-man defensive secondary look or nickel coverage. 34-21 is our score. Miami leading, third and 12. And Kosar is knocked down. And this is an inspired Maryland football club. Bruce Messner, 276-pound New York tackle.
Number 56 as well, Scott Tye, putting some, there's 75, Messner, excuse me, Messner's 83. And he comes in from the outside, gets the shoulder down, and Kosar trips over him. So we'll have Tootin in. Only the second punt of the day for Miami, and they both come in the second half.
And it'll be Keita Covington. That's the man right there standing at the 50-yard line with the wind behind him. Look at this kick. And Covington back to the 46. A nice kick that time by Rick Tootin. He really got a boomer away, didn't he? 56 yards. Oh, those kickers love to kick with the wind. All right, 13-13 to play. Miami 34, Maryland 21 from the Orange Bowl in Miami.
Excited as the score with Houston and Texas being announced, the 20-10 score, and these fans very knowledgeable, realizing that they perhaps have a chance to pick up Another spot in the ranking. Also, as we said earlier, the state of Florida having some tremendous ball clubs, three in about the top 11 spots with Florida State, Florida, and also, of course, Miami. And Florida, as I recall, Eddie, well ahead of Georgia. Georgia hasn't scored on them yet. So it's a good day for football in the Southeast.
Right now, Maryland trying to come back, and they've done a good job so far in the third period, or the third quarter, now in the fourth. Frank Reich will try and lead the way again. He's got Blount and Badonic, the running backs. That's Badonic. Maybe a yard. Big Kevin Fagan again. He bench presses 525 pounds. Badonic, who's a 223-pounder, just got hit by a rolling truck. The size of these kids. And
well, they're bigger than most pro football teams were a couple of years ago. And I'm not saying 30 years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago.
Hill and Holder stretch to the far side. Right to throw. Under. That is Blount. The ball started on the 46. He gets past the midfield mark. He needed 9 on the first down. He's going to be a little short of it, maybe a couple of yards. Fleming and Fullington. It's the linebacker and the free safety that stopped him.
Obviously, he's not hitting his primary receiver. He's looking down the field, senses a little bit of pressure, throws out to the safety valve, is able to move on down the field now. So Alvin Blount gets close to the first down. We've got third and about 2.
Abdul Raouf and Milling are in the ball game now. And somebody lost a helmet down there as Maryland trying to go for the first down. As Badonic was tackled by John McVay, the linebacker. And it's a first and 10.
McVay has a great chance to sack him for a loss here. McVay moves across, makes the hit. It's number 93, McVay, but Badonic with that forward motion gets the first down.
Jerome Brown was the man that lost the helmet. We're under 12 to play. 34-21, Maryland trying to move it. Ball at the 44, first and 10. Holder and Hill. And on the running play, right inside the 40, close to the 35-yard line, goes little Rick Badonic, the low rider. Look at the size of him.
A lot of experience, too. He played a lot in the 82 season, had 9 touchdowns, I think, also had 9 last year. And as we've said, is also a good pass receiver, which is a little bit surprising for somebody 5'9", as stockily built as he is.
He has 30 career touchdowns, Kyle. Under 11 to play. Reich on the play action pass. Deep, and he has a man. Oh, he had a man. He had the deep coverage beat. It was Abdul Raouf. They had Sutton and Daryl Fullington beat, and he underthrew him just a touch.
Just thrown a little bit late as Raouf is going down the field. He's number 87. He has to slow up a little bit. And we see a superb play by Reggie Sutton, the sophomore. Comes in, gets a hand on the ball.
Raouf can run a 40 and 4-3. Eric Holder to the near side. Milling is also near side. High formation, 3rd and 2. Going to be close. A change of direction veer that time, as it was Neal, the running back, Tommy Neal. And lots of people around the ball.
I don't think they're going to place it right where he was tackled. He did have forward motion a little bit up close to the 34-yard line. Let's see, the guy that is doing the job on him there for Miami is number 45, and that's George Myra Jr.
Yeah, he did a nice job, but this is a big call now because I don't believe it's a first down. And now Bobby Ross has got to make a decision whether you protect the field or take a shot at it. At this point in the game, I think he's got to go for it. What do you think?
Yeah, well, they've tried what they had to. They tried the onside kicks. They were willing to give Miami the ball near midfield anyway. And Miami has not really been stopped by bad field position. They in the first half took the ball in their 2 and scored a touchdown. So, yeah, they got to go for it.
And it looks like the balance of statistics has turned to Maryland in the second half. 34-21. Miami with a lead, but Maryland has the ball. And a fourth and less than a yard. Double tight end. And he's got the first down. But Donick, he slipped behind the blocking on the left side that time. He had Lynch and Glover and Bill Hughes, and he had to go inside, and he got the running room he needed for the first and 10.
Yeah, the first and 10 was really not made by Badonic, though he did carry the ball. But it's the people like Lynch, number 63 there, number 73 for Maryland, Marleveld, that really picked up the yardage, and Badonic just able to walk behind that wall.
Marleveld, the 300-pounder. Azizadin on the far side, Wright coming near. And that is the tight end. And a good one, Farrell Edmonds. This is the fourth game that he started. He's the man that I told you was invited out by Lefty Grizzell to the basketball team.
With the fake motion in the backfield, it holds up the Miami pursuit a little bit because Miami's got to be play the possible reverse, honestly. And that did allow Farrell Edmonds to get down the field. And Reich doing a good job rolling out, throwing on the run.
That stopped the clock for a moment. Now it's rolling and down to 9.5 to play. Maryland with a chance to cut this lead. Again, pitch back, Tommy Neal. He's going to the pylon. Touchdown! What a comeback by Maryland. A 14-yarder. And somehow, some way, Maryland has found a few holes in that Miami defense. And with 9:20 to play, they're back and striking.
Well, it's high risk here as Miami tries to come in and pursue. And the approach really from that secondary, trying to catch him in the backfield. If you go into the backfield and you miss your man, you really put the safety under a lot of stress, and the Miami rest of the secondary could just not get over there in time.
Atkinson adds,
Miami 34,
and it's now 34-28. So they are a touchdown away from tying it, and you won't want to go away now. We have 9:20 to play, and it's really exciting at the Orange Bowl. Now, 34-28 Miami. It was 31-7 not long ago.
You've got some Terrapin fans on their feet because of runs like this. Tommy Neal, the running back, young sophomore, all the way to the cone in the corner. And they're not even within a touchdown. They're within a touchdown, an extra point of going ahead. 34-28.
Right now is 10 of 13 for 175 yards and two touchdown passes since he's come on in the second half. Atkinson to kick.
Go deep again. It's not going to go all the way to the end zone, I don't think. Well, now it does.
Well, they took a gamble on that one, Kyle, kicking into the wind. Terrell Oliver was up. Well, they were expecting that probably they couldn't reach the end zone with the wind. As a result.
Well, actually, Miami's the one that's lucky there because the ball did go ahead and bound on into the end zone. Miami had put nine players up front expecting perhaps the onside kick. And they do now get it on the 20, but it could very well have put them inside their own five.
First and 10 on the 20. Kozar, the quarterback. Melvin Bratton and Darrell Oliver are the running backs. I'll make that the youngster Williams now. That's Bratton. And it was Scott Shankweiler, along with Al Covington on the far side. Fawcett, the linebacker, also in there working. Bratton and the young running back here, Warren Williams. There's that last scoring drive.
Well, lots of yards, nine plays, and they got plenty of time. Still got almost 9 minutes to go based on that example. And,
just a little
Miami under. Just can't hold on to the ball and hope that they can take time off the clock. They've had Maryland's had four possessions in the second half, has four touchdowns, and they're going to have to get some points themselves.
Second and two, ball on the 28. That's Bratton again. Steve Kelly, the end. He made the stop. Alonzo Highsmith is out. They lost him, and looks like somebody is down on the field and hurt for Miami or for Maryland.
Well, that kind of helps Maryland. They got a player injured, which is never a nice situation. And that is 53, that's Steve Kelly, but it does stop the clock. And they don't have to take the timeout.
Right now, with 9 carries and 58 yards. So while we have this opportunity, we'll send it to Royal. University of Miami 34, Maryland 28. It's a good one at the Orange Bowl.
Soldier, we know you.
Yes, can't beat it. Bratton now has 9 carries, 58 yards. And 5 catches for 157 yards. He's has over 200 yards total offense. And there he is. Shakespeare gave him a pretty good block and allowed him to get to the corner before the linebacker, Eric Wilson, brought him down.
Yeah, you
was
know,
that Charlie's Angels or what was that?
I think when the explorers came to North America looking for the Fountain of Youth 500 years ago and didn't find it, they could have just come back 500 years from then. And not only do you have a very youthful skill position backfield for Miami, but you got a lot of youth in the crowd as well.
A little history lesson from Kyle Rhodes Jr. 34-28 our score. Second down and 3 on the 42-yard line. Out of the eye. That's Warren Williams, the freshman running back. Chuck Fawcett, one of the linebackers. Al Covington, the safety. He made sure he didn't go any further than that. Boy, Bratton's having a beautiful day, isn't he?
Yep. Think about the pressure, though. You know, you're a coach, and you wonder, can you put a freshman in there? You got your top back, Alonzo Highsmith, who's out for probably several weeks. You hope that with the two-week break between now and Boston College that he can be back, but got lots of youth in that backfield.
Remember, this is a Maryland defense. It's number one in the ACC against the rush. First and 10 on the 45. Boom. I mean, boom. And Bratton was nailed by Chuck Fawcett. Oh, boy.
Isn't Fawcett, he's the guy that spent a couple of years in the Blue Jays farm system in baseball. And he and number 55 there, Eric Wilson, the twin linebackers, spent a lot of time with one another. They spent a lot of time with the backfield of Miami today.
Only his friends are allowed to call him Leaky. I'll let you play with that.
I'm not about to.
34-28 is our score. 6-11. Miami with the lead in the ball. That's out of bounds. Well, Bratton was there. He was the intended receiver. They throw it out of bounds. There's Bernie Kosar, who has been curtailed by that Maryland defense here in the second half.
Yeah, smart play by Kosar to just loft the ball out of play. We take a look on the far side, some of the coverage of the Maryland defense. See those two bumps as wide receivers from Miami trying to get deep. Well, they're making those bumps right at the limit there.
There's Bernie Kosar, who's 23 of 37 and 302 yards for the day. Brown. And over there to try and defend and doing so nicely was Donald Brown. No relation. And just back after surgery to an injured finger. And there's the curly-haired man from Boardman, Ohio.
Well, the linebackers must be doing a much better job of covering the people coming out of the backfield because Kosar again is throwing into a double coverage as Brown comes over to help out on the quarterback.
Fourth down and 10, ball on the 45. Tootin to kick short.
It's not bad, though. It should not be returned.
Well, he used as much of the field as he could, and it'll be down to the 15-yard line. Well, Kosar now is 4 for 9 and 62 yards in the second half after having 240 yards passing in the first half. We have 5:47 to play. It's Miami 34, Maryland 28. Maryland 28. The crowd wants Miami to hold here. Maryland 85 yards from tying. A PAT would put them ahead. It was 31-7 at halftime. Oh
boy. I'm really amazed. I did not think Maryland could come back from that. The points they gave up in the first half, the 31 points, was more than they had given up total in any game this whole year. And I just felt that would break their back. But they came back in the second half, tried to at least break the momentum to get a start at it. But with this new addition of number 14, Frank Reich, into that backfield, they have come on like gangbusters.
I said 31-7. I meant 31-0. They've scored 28 points in the second half. Reich's the quarterback. But Donick is the fullback. And over the 30-yard line, trying to go to Eric Holder, one of the wideouts. And they do.
Well, that was a precision pass because he had to get it over one linebacker, had to get it inside the other. So watch the move, drive the secondary man back, push off on the outside. Holder moves right there. And Reich is, I think, Eddie, he's around a 64% completion passer coming into the game.
So he was 64%. He, as we said, has the stronger arm. Abdur Rauf and Hill to the near side, the wideouts in a slot. Play action again. This is Reich into the wind. He's got it. That's Hill. Off of Darrell Fullington. Maryland has tied it. 68 yards. What is going to happen now?
Oh, they're going to kick the extra point is what they're going to do.
Yeah, but with 5:29 to play, what excitement in the second half.
Oh, my goodness. For Darrell Fullington, number 19 for Miami, a freshman, potential All-American, he will not forget this interception opportunity right in his hands. And number 14 keeps great concentration. That's Greg Hill. Goes all the way in. And for a Miami defense that has never given up a touchdown pass over 50 yards, at least this year, that is doubly hurting.
That is incredible. Right now, 12 of 15 for 260 yards. That even is a better performance than Kozar's performance in the first half. Wow. 5:29. Atkinson, the all-time leader. And Maryland has taken the lead with 5:29, the ACC leader against the number 6 team in the nation. Trailing 31-0, they've outscored Miami 34-3 here in the second half. Hill now, 8 catches, 182 yards, and a couple of touchdowns. Whoa, baby.
They've done it all going into this wind as well. Well, they are used to playing against good teams, as we told you. Maryland still has Clemson to go, but they've already played Penn State and West Virginia and Syracuse. Played some good ball clubs.
All it took was 2 plays, 85 yards, 18 seconds. And Jimmy Johnson and the Miami Hurricanes are a nervous group, and they do not have Alonzo Highsmith. He went down in the first half, re-injuring a knee, at a time when his team had a big enough lead that he probably shouldn't have been in there.
Yep.
Now when they need him, they don't have him.
Well, the clouds beginning to roll in here at the Orange Bowl, and clouds have rolled in into the mind of Coach Jimmy Johnson and their staff, as their thinking certainly has got to have changed. For the first time today, they're behind. So we see the scoring drive now, just 2 plays, as Eddie told you. Only 18 seconds, 85 yards. I don't know that I could go 85 yards in 18 seconds, but it's that 68-yard touchdown play from Reich to Hill.
And here we go. Dropped by Staffier. And Maryland is right on it. They may have it. Maryland's got the football.
Well, you've got 2 officials standing up that have indicated Maryland with the ball.
That was J.C. Penny, Kyle. Here he is coming out, number 21.
Ball bouncing away, and here, of course, the coaches tell you, just dive on the ball. Don't dare try to pick it up. He does the best job that he can. from Maryland, I think it was Lewis Askew, number 13, sophomore defensive back, who gets the ball. Tell you what, if I were a betting man, I would have lost all sorts of money on this one if someone had asked me at halftime if Maryland could come back.
Penny fumbling on the six, recovered by Maryland. First and goal in the six with 5:22. Right from the eye. And that is Blount, I believe. Number 33, Alvin Blount.
McVay made the stop at 2-yard gain. Second and goal at the four.
Second and goal at the four. John McVay was the linebacker on the tackle. Greg Hill comes off for Maryland. Number 22, James Milling, comes to the near side. Two tight ends in the ball game. They have Rogers and Edwards. And they give it to Badonic, and he's in! Wow, what a turnaround we have had here. Jimmy Johnson cannot believe it. And neither can a crowd of around 50,000 at the Orange Bowl today. An incredible second half comeback by Maryland. And they now lead 41-34. And remember, if Miami scores, they got to go for the two-pointer if Atkinson kicks it here. He's got it. It's Maryland 42, Miami 34, with 4:42 to play. And we're at the Orange Bowl in Miami with quite a football game here today.
Second half, the scoring, 42 points for Maryland, 3 for the University of Miami. And we have got a lot of shocked people sitting here in the Orange Bowl. About 2,000 fans from Maryland making the trip. They were sitting on their seats the whole first half.
Next week, Kyle, good game.
Yeah, we've got Doug Flutie one more time. Have an opportunity to see the man that seems to be the odds-on favorite for the Heisman Trophy balloting. And, of course, it is nice that he is up there in that very influential northeastern part of the country. But I haven't seen anybody better. And even when he loses, he has an ability to pull games and put points on the board that you would think would be impossible.
Maryland has outscored Miami 42-3 in the second half. Whoa, my goodness gracious. Bobby Ross, this is the most incredible comeback you've given us this year, or any team has given us on USA. Miami was a favorite, number 6 rated. Atkinson to kick it off. It's 42-34. I wonder what he said to them at halftime.
Well, I think he says, you know, as we mentioned, you can't do it all at once. You're not going to be able to come back from a 31-0 deficit in 5 minutes. Let's just score one touchdown, get us within 3 touchdowns. And
Darrell Oliver runs it out of bounds. So Darrell Oliver with 4:36 to play. And Miami in their biggest drive of the year. This is a very, very big game for them because they're looking to move up in the ratings and they're also looking for a trip to the Orange Bowl. So it'll be Bernie Kosar. We'll see if he can engineer against a fired up defense now. They've got Oliver and Bratton, the running backs. Shakespeare, who's not been out there as far as a pass receiver, has not caught a pass. Eddie Brown, near side, Shakespeare 5. Four-man rush. Oh, what a hit. What a hit, Eddie Brown. He dropped the ball, and it was Donald Brown going after Eddie Brown.
Tell you what, they gave him a false. They gave Kosar a false cue. The safety is so far to Kosar's right. He thinks single coverage is there, so he lost the ball for Brown. And here he comes, number 2. Donald Brown, he was on the far hash mark in a sprinter stance trying to give Kosar the false cue to think there would be single coverage.
Second down and 10. Kosar again. That's Eddie Brown.
But he doesn't get the first down despite the completion, so they've still got a third and about 4.
And that is the first pass reception to Eddie Brown today, the number two receiver on this team. Coming in, he had 47 receptions for 882 yards. Number two in terms of catches, number one in terms of total yards. So they've hung him up pretty well. They've completely shut off Shakespeare, who is the number three receiver behind Willie Smith. Third and distance to go now as go Willie Smith. Well, Willie Smith on the catch.
Two-minute hurry-up offense as Miami players. You see Willie Smith breathing hard. Miami at the line of scrimmage, first and 10.
Willie Smith now with 11 catches. That ties the team record. He's the one that established that. Kosar, there's his man. And it's Willie Smith. And that is a new record. Individual receptions for a single game. And out of bounds with 3:39 to play.
Tired young man, but he needs some extra energy right now.
Well, he got them their yards in the first half. And now they're going back to him again. First down and 10. That was some pass to Willie Smith. Maryland trying to tighten it up. They own an 8-point lead with 3:39. And this is the kind of game we expected originally. Shakespeare near, Brown far side, wide receivers. Kosar. That is Bratton. What a catch.
No,
they're saying it's incomplete.
It. Yep.
Donald Brown was there. Richie Pettibone was there. Second and 10, 46-yard line. Bernie Kosar. Eddie Brown. Oh, he had it and lost it. He had it. He lost it.
You know, when he dropped that pass, he dropped that pass about four plays ago. That pass dropped several plays ago.
This is a huge third down coming up. Kosar with Bratton, one of the running backs. Oliver is the other running back. Third and 10. They've been successful quite often on third down plays, but not this time. It's intended for Willie Smith. It's Joe Krause who is there.
Well, they're getting enough pressure out on the outside now as we take a look at the kind of coverage that the Miami, oh, here's just a replay of our earlier pass. Here's the look again. Watch the quick look. There's another look. He knows what's getting ready to happen. Here comes number two from Maryland, Donald Brown.
That hurt. That really hurt.
Well, hurt him more in his pride than it did physically.
Ball on the 46-yard line.
Got to go, fourth down.
Fourth down and 10. Shakespeare near, Brown far side. What a big play this is. He's got his man.
Can he get the first down? He does.
An outstanding effort on the far side of the field by Darrell Oliver. That was a super effort.
Maryland with a wall of defense right at that
10 yards and 10 on the 35. Intercepted. And hanging on to the football is Richie Pettibone. Pettibone, the freshman linebacker, son of the former NFL great, Rich Pettibone Sr. And with 2:55 to play, Maryland with another interception on Kosar. And what a big one that was. So Bernie Kosar trying to find the man in the seam. And now it's going to be tough, 42-34 with 2:55 to play in the ball game. Maryland with the ball and with the lead. Miami, incidentally, with three timeouts remaining.
Not since Miami played against Michigan earlier when they had six interceptions against Miami, as Kosar had more than one interception in the ball game.
Now it becomes a ball control game here if they can. Maryland with Blount being tackled by Fleming. 2:37 to play and the clock is running. Coming into the lineup defensively for the University of Miami is Willie Lee Bruton. And they'll get one of the D-backs out of there and they'll go with an extra rush man on a second down and six. sound like Henry Aldridge. Reich on the pitch. And Blount again. Miami hoping to get the ball back, but you can look for Maryland to give it as long a count as possible. And Miami will take one of their remaining three timeouts with 2:07 to play.
Well, you've got to have school there, and they had almost 600 high school coaches. You can imagine what the number one question is going to be next year. How did you do it in the second half against Miami?
Third and five on the 37. 2:05 to play. Reich stumbles and falls. Is he hurt?
That's the only time he's stumbled at all in his leadership of this ball club.
Kyle, this might be a big, big play here because now they're going to be in a position where they've got to kick. They may have been able to pull off a first down and keep it going.
Yep.
We have 1:58 to play. And it's going to be Darryl Wright, the freshman, in to kick, and he'll kick it into the wind. And now we'll get a chance to see if Miami will be able to take advantage of that wind.
Very unfortunate for Reich as he gets his feet on this natural turf. See a few little divots. They water this field every day. It's a little bit moist, though it is a pretty firm field. It's in great shape for all the games that are played on it.
You know, it comes back to mind, don't you, Kyle? That last touchdown in the Orange Bowl that Miami pulled off in less than a minute with the Kosar,
yep,
to win the game. He's capable of doing it, and we have a minute and 58 to play.
Well, the decision for Jimmy Johnson here is, do you go for the block kick, or do you just try to set up the return? We'll have a chance to see as they line up for this punt.
Wright has had a 48-yard kicking average today. He's done an outstanding job. Coming in, he was averaging 39.7. Now, Miami will have to look up into the sun for one of the rare times. The clouds have been covering the sun pretty well, but Brown's going to have to look up into a very bright sun, and he may have to shield. Bad snap. A block kick. Here comes Miami.
Oh, my goodness. Incredible.
I don't believe it.
Victor Morris, defensive end for Miami, picks up the ball after a low snap. It's not really the kicker's fault.
But there may be a flag. Hold on.
They're going to put the ball down. They said he picked it up. If the fumble is bouncing and he's able to pick it up out of the air, he's able to run with it. Here's the snap. Darryl Wright, the punter. It's a low punt. He tries to field the skip hop and tries to get the kick off. And miss kicks it. And they're going to say he picked it up off the ground.
The snapper on the play is Eddie Schultz. And he didn't get one of his better ones off. And now Jimmy Johnson wants an interpretation from the referee.
Challenge every game.
So whatever, Bernie Kosar is going to have some room. And the official has given the indication, as Kyle had told you, that you can't move it, and now it's at the 18-yard line with Brown to the far side, Shakespeare to the near. A big break here, and now how big would that first down have been had Reich not slipped? Huh? Bernie Kosar is the quarterback. Elvin Bratton, one of the running backs. There he is. He's got it. And inside the 15-yard line. So he gets four. It'll be a second down and six. And the clock is still running. A minute 35, 34, 33.
Only have one timeout left.
And they're going to try and kill that clock as it keeps ticking away. There's Bratton, a flag down. He goes to the six, but there's a flag thrown on the play. It was thrown by the back judge.
Yeah. Willie Smith was being held up. And Willie Smith has been a favorite target of Kosar, and he was just getting battered by the linebacker.
Oh, and the clock is moving. Bernie Kosar under Sinclair. Bratton. Brown, touchdown, Eddie Brown.
Well, it's a two-step process. They're part of the way there. But they've got to pick up 2 points here on the conversion. Nice isolation. Kosar lost the ball up in the air. Eddie Brown out jumps the defense.
That's Joe Krause, who is back there to cover him.
Eddie Brown with his ninth touchdown reception of the year. There's a single coverage.
That's the 14th career touchdown for Eddie Brown. That also is a school record. They're going for two. They need two to tie. Can they? No! Melvin Bratton. Oh, was he blasted by Keita Covington? And Keita Covington's brother Al was right there to give him some help. Well, that's got to be the strategy now as Melvin Bratton is being helped off the field. He's played a brilliant ball game.
Can't possibly let Maryland get possession with only one timeout left. There's no way to kill that much time off the clock and get the ball back.
Bratton has had to fill in for Alonzo Highsmith, who was injured and actually moving out of position. Normally a running back, he's gone over to play the fullback for most of this second half.
Now, Eddie, interestingly, a lot of ball clubs have several different kinds of onside kicks. They've got the short onside kick, getting the ball about 10 yards. They've got the deep onside kick, about 35 yards. And they got a medium one where they try to put the ball about the 30-yard line and put your sprinters out on the left side, which is where they're putting them, and hope that they can outrace.
Timeouts remaining right there, Kyle. Maryland 3, Miami 1. Miami trails by 2. We have 1 minute to play. It's 42-40, Maryland with the lead, and they will get set to receive. Look for the onsider, Keita Covington, back, but I don't really believe. Now he's going to cheat and come up. Bratton, incidentally, has been great. 162 yards, pass receiving, 65 yards rushing. Here it comes. Wide open! Joe Krause is going to be pulled out at the goal line. The onside kick backfired. They did not kick it far enough to get to the pursuit, and that's the chance you take. It's like a man in basketball stepping up and playing the passing lanes and picking one off and going in for a slam dunk.
Well, the difference is here, his style of kicking is kick it off the ground and try to knock the ball, hope it will bounce crazy so that your people can pick it up. We've seen Maryland, when they've had the onside kick, they've lofted the ball up into the air, have not tried to play it against the ground. And we've got Maryland in a position they can now think about bowls, in Miami really struggling at this point for their chance at a second national championship.
Maryland, if they win, will go 6-3, and they will have won 4 in a row. Maryland trying to drive it through there. All they have to do now is let that clock continue to roll, and it is ticking away. It is down to 45 seconds, and Maryland holding on to a 42-40 lead, and that man you just saw, Frank Reich, is the man that made the difference in the second half today for Maryland. No question about it.
Well, that's got to be, again, a tremendous opportunity, and for someone like this now in his last year, Frank Reich, a senior, played behind great quarterback the last couple years, to have his chance at glory against last year's national champs.
Tommy Neal and Badonica, the running backs. Second and goal. And all Maryland's trying to do right now is hang on to the ball.
Not too many times you get first and goal from the one and you don't try to score.
Boy, has Reich been beautiful. He's 12 for 15. Consulate Bernie Kosar. A couple of interceptions have not helped his chances. And a misfire and an onside kick has put Maryland down there right where they want to go with 7 seconds to play. And thoughts of the Orange Bowl just starting to slip through the fingers of the University of Miami. Despite the fact he's had 355 yards, Gosar is going to come up dry.
Well, they'll still go to a bowl, Eddie, as you know, but it's just going to be a matter of what level of bowl will they go to. And unfortunately, an athletic directorship type of parlance, this loss may be a multi-hundred-thousand-dollar loss for this Miami program.
And this is what you call your victory offense, and that's Frank Reich that's going to run away with it. Maryland has pulled their biggest win of the year. And for the second time in 3 years, Bobby Ross is going to get a victory ride. He beat Miami 18-17 2 years ago in Maryland. And he has come back in miracle fashion here today after trailing 31-0 at halftime and pulled off an incredible win.
And I know I'll change if you leave or stay. But when our world turns where it's turning to, you'll see.